best action movie of the year is on Blu-ray. Star Trek Beyond, on Blu-ray and digital HD now.
ESPN College Football presented by McDonald's. And we are here at Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama for the 75th annual Magic City Classic. And it is a spectacle unlike any I personally have ever seen. Thousands inside and outside, the teams made their way down A&M, of course, from the Huntsville area and from Montgomery, Alabama State to converge right here at Legion Field.
Inside the stadium.
And continue this rivalry since 1946 inside Legion Field, where 60,000 plus expected inside the stadium, more than 100,000 plus expected outside of the stadium. And we have opened the game with the kickoff. And as we get ready,
sorry, guys,
to go, that was Palmer Graham who returned that one. A&M won the toss and chose to defer until the second half.
Here's coaches, guys. They screwed me.
So Brian Jenkins and James Spady, the head coaches on the respective sides of the field in this rivalry. As Alabama State takes over, Quinteris Toppings, dual threat at quarterback.
And Toppings, new quarterback slider after this.
Gives it to his halfback and leading rusher Khalid Thomas. And Thomas, good yardage across midfield, picked up six. As they were anxious to get it on out here at Legion Field.
There's your quarterback.
For the continuation of this rivalry. Toppings, nicknamed QT around here, has improved all season long, been steady at the quarterback spot since some injuries have forced him into more consistent play at that position for Coach Jenkins. Khalid Thomas now makes it an empty backfield going to the slot near side. Here's Toppings under some pressure. He loses control of the football. And who's got it underneath? I think maybe an Alabama State lineman pounced on it. And he did. That was number 74, Sam Batiste, who recovered that one.
Yeah, Toppings trying to pass some extra time in the pocket. You have to have better ball security. You'll see the ball drop below his waist. When you do that as a quarterback, that's too far away. Easy to become disengaged with the football. The Hornets fortunate to recover the fumble.
It'll be third and very long. Toppings, a quick wide receiver screen, and he had some blockers in front. He was looking for Willis White, one of the leading wideouts for Alabama State, but he just couldn't hold on to that one. So a quick three and out for the Hornets, and they'll be forced to punt.
And you know, this is such an intense rivalry game between the two schools, and Brian Jenkins, head coach of Alabama State, one of the most intense coaches you will see in FCS football. And this is the type of game that brings out everything. You know, the team that's supposed to win by a lot has lost this game before, and the underdog has been competitive. And with so much riding on the line this season, I think we're in for a whale of a football game here at Birmingham.
And it was Rashad Anderson, fair catches that one. It'll be marked right at the 15-yard line where the Bulldogs will take over, first and 10. We are looking at the top two rushing teams in the SWAC conference, and in part because of their dual threat quarterbacks. This is D'Angelo Tootie Ballard. Tootie, a nickname given to him by grandma. And in a word, this guy was bad for the first three or four games. His coaches thought so, players thought so, but he has made a steady improvement, especially over the last three or four weeks.
He almost lost his starting job, and a little bit different for Alabama A&M, where the whole offense is reliant upon Ballard. If he does not play well, they cannot win football games, and he has to have his best game of the year here in his final Magic City Classic.
Jordan Bentley on the carry there, stacked up, and there's Coach Spady in his third season.
That's his record in the class.
9-21 overall, and he is 1-1.
And he understands the importance of this game,
mm-hmm,
because his first year, Alabama A&M had only won one game, maybe two games going into it, and they upset Alabama State. So he won the first one that gave him some life. But now he's on a little bit of a hot seat. He needs to win this game, keep everything secure in Huntsville.
Quick swing to the near side that time. He was looking for and found Tevin McKenzie. But McKenzie brought down after a gain of about six. And that'll make it third and short.
You know, just to cap off about Spady winning that game, it's not confirmed, it's unofficial, but I truly believe that when Alabama State lost that game, I thought that ended Reggie Barlow's head coaching career at Alabama State. And that's why they brought in Brian Jenkins the following season.
On third down, Bowden has a lot of room. And then he went back behind the first down marker. Gets a little help from a couple of his offensive linemen to push him outside of the 25-yard line. That should be enough for first down.
Fortunate they're going to get the first down, but they easily should have had a touchdown.
Here it comes.
Take a look at the zone coverage you're going to see. Top of your screen. Watch who covers this man running. Tell me, is he open? I think you can hit this route right here. They're going to try and do a little spin route on the inside to distract you. They don't even see him. He's open the whole time. Instead, looking at the rush, missed opportunity for a big play for the Bulldogs.
Ballard under heavy pressure gets out of it somehow. And he turns the corner across the 30, still in bounds. No, they're going to mark him out at the 32, or he'd still be running. Ballard picked up six as it stands, but he could have picked up a lot more had he just stayed in bounds.
Yeah, you feel like on the sideline. When you're that close, you have to know where you are. Make a hard plant with your left foot. He might have been in bounds.
Wow.
But don't make it so close where the official can blow the whistle. It's there. Make sure you take a look down and let everybody know that you know you're in bounds and you're not going to get hit.
When he was whistled out of bounds on the play, that's it. That's where they're going to spot it. So a nice pickup after he escaped what looked like a sure sack on the blitz that time by the Alabama State defense. So an A&M now second and short. And here's Bentley trying to get the corner. Cannot. And he is taken down by multiple white shirts on the far side of the field. One of them, Courtney Berry, their All-American linebacker.
And this is that he lost one. Let's see from the field level, can we see, does he go out of bounds? Yeah.
Maybe. So. Maybe with that left foot.
Right there. I thought he could have stayed in bounds. Mm-hmm. You know, a little bit more present on the field. There was no threat to him on the inside. As a quarterback, you have to know where you are on the field and stay in bounds. That could have been a huge play.
Third down and five, empty backfield for Ballard. Buying some extra time, flag down on the play, going deep down the sideline, and that one is out of bounds. Even if he would have caught it, Tevin McKenzie would not have been in bounds, but we do have a flag at the 20.
No question, that's holding on the left tackle.
Penalties
decline.
Fourth down.
Tavoris Butler, true freshman center on the hole. They call him Big Baby. And he makes a big hold right here.
I think this is a hold right here on the
left
side.
You think it's a tackle?
Yeah, I think they called the wrong number. You'll see once Ballard leaves the pocket, which is going to be right now, that's
okay.
A hold. All that jersey that's in there, that's Malcolm Johnson, number 78.
Actually, it may have been Derek Isaac, 73. And in any case, Alabama State, little lane on the punt return. Cross midfield. One man to beat now. And inside the 20, down at the 17-yard line. What a return by Khalid Thomas. And Thomas sets up Alabama State in great field position. They are already in the red zone. We are scoreless here in the 75th Magic City Classic.
One.
With the stop. First and 10, Alabama State from the 16-yard line.
At wallrealguys.com.
We're producing record amounts of oil and natural gas. We've got to move it, store it, transport it safely. With smart policies, we'll get it where it needs to go and create a whole lot of jobs and opportunity right here. I'm John, and I'm an energy voter.
Manny
Pacquiao is an all-time great.
Crashing shots down by Vargas. And down he goes. Good fight, Sotomayor.
Pacquiao versus Vargas. Saturday, November 5th, live on pay-per-view.
Saturday, 2-1. We're back.
Welcome back. Warm afternoon. Happy Classic Weekend if you're down here in the Birmingham, Alabama area. Alabama State and A&M are scoreless. 39-yard punt and a 54-yard return by Khalid Thomas puts Alabama State in great shape at the 16-yard line, already in the red zone, with Quinteris Toppings leading the way at quarterback.
After this play, guys, stand by for impact players. Thomas, Alabama State, Kenneth Davis, A&M. Stand by after this play.
Here's Khalid Thomas up the middle, and he's wide open. Nobody touched him. Touchdown. 16 yards by Khalid Thomas, so he gets 54 on the punt return and another 16 on the first play of the drive in the red zone to put the Hornets up top 6-0.
And Thomas, the second leading rusher in the SWAC, showing his ability to locate the hole right up the middle, but a great job by the center. Number 66, Kerry Williams with a seal block. Not a good sign when you let your running back waltz into the end zone in the middle of the defense.
We're going to get in another break here.
David Albert converts the extra point. So, like lightning, the Hornets strike quickly after the long punt return and the 16-yard touchdown run. It's 7-0 Alabama State.
2-1.
ESPNU College Football is presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it. And in part by Wall Clippers and Trimmers. Real guys, real grooming. Visit wallrealguys.com. Now playing on DirecTV Cinema.
My dad joined Starfleet because he believed in it. I joined on a dare.
You joined to see if you could live up to him.
This is my last report as the captain of the Starship Enterprise.
Hold on to something!
Movie start at Channel 125.
My name's Emma. I am 15. I was bullied all through middle school. That's when I was diagnosed with depression, anxiety, and an eating disorder.
It's like I'm stuck. It's like impossible to move. And I just feel like people just will think I'm making it up.
You need to tell someone because people do care and you're not alone. I don't think depression makes me a bad person. I think it makes me stronger.
Magic City Classic Weekend, this is what it's all about. Hundreds of RVs and thousands of grills, people cooking and seasoning up the ribs and saying, my ribs are better than everybody else's, come try these. And that's where I want to go. I'm going right here after that for the turkey legs. 75th anniversary of this game, first played back in 1924. Again, over 60,000 expected inside. More than 100,000 are outside, and we went through about 80,000 of them getting in here today, Jay. And everybody in a festive mood, and a huge economic impact, of course, for the city of Birmingham.
And I tell everybody, they ask around the country, you know, what's the best HBCU game? This is it. It ain't even close for second. And you've seen it now. Is it as big as I told you it was?
It's bigger than you told me it was.
And they're mad because you said only a couple of hundred RVs outside.
Maybe it's a couple of thousand.
It's a couple of thousand RVs. And they start tailgating here on Tuesday. On Tuesday.
Wow.
Think about it. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. It's a lot of ribs and smoked turkey leg here at Clemens.
O'Darius Williams kneels down for the touchback. So A&M will take over first and 10 on its own 20. And it, you know, 25, I'm sorry. I'm thinking I'm looking at the NFL, I guess. 25-yard line.
And it's going to be important for A&M because, you know, if you ask me, you see the records are identical, but, you know, don't know who's winning. But on paper, it seems like Alabama State has an advantage, a little bit more used to winning. But A&M, they're going to have to stay competitive in here. They're going to need some big plays from D'Angelo Ballard when they're there. Take the opportunities to try and exploit the secondary of Alabama State.
Both these teams used to moving the chains, and Jordan Bentley just runs into a wall of black and white, and he lost at least a yard on the play. So they are not opening up a lot of holes. Big Roderick Henderson, in the best shape of his life, down from about 370, was the first one in there. 6'1", 352-pound, 50-year senior.
Stand by. after this play.
It'll be second and 11 after that one-yard loss. And immediately grabbing the quarterback and throwing him down, number 55 on the defensive side of the ball. That was Garrett Oden, backup defensive tackle with the sack for a nine-yard loss, and Ballard didn't have a chance. As soon as he got it, 55 was there in his face.
Yeah, the offensive line play for Alabama A&M, which has been their weak link all season long, showing up here early in this contest. Poor protection and not blowing off the line of scrimmage. And the Hornets are having their way on the defensive line.
Third and very long. As Ballard rolling out to buy some time. And he runs out of it, but still spins away from the tackle and is able to get the ball away safely out of bounds, incomplete. So it'll be a three and out as they go 10 yards the wrong way. And they're going to have to punt this one away and give Alabama State the ball, which might be in pretty good field position.
Not a good sign. D'Angelo Ballard's your best offensive player. The coaches have pretty much said that. I don't know how well he's seeing the field right now because of the offensive line woes that these have. It seems like he's looking at the rush and not looking downfield through his progressions.
And they've got two true freshmen on that starting offensive line, Tavoris Butler and Shanye Reams. Both of them were also high school teammates. And the punt gotten away by Nick Carton. And this time, Khalid Thomas is hit. As soon as he catches it, he'll be a little bit short of midfield. 35-yard punt with zero on the return as Alabama State gets ready to take over.
The side of the ball.
Desmond Fletcher on the tackle. Impact players? Talk about these guys.
Well, I think Khalid Thomas has already made an impact in this game. Transfer from the University of Kentucky. He's a senior. This will be his last classic. And Kenneth Davis, the inside linebacker, 70 tackles on the season to lead this ball club. That's a lot of tackles by a great linebacker.
His second leading tackler in the SWAC. And he took over because the starter this season, Brian Brower, was injured early. Opened the door for Davis, and Davis has taken over and run with it at that Mike linebacker spot. On first down. And running into a pile of maroon shirts. 3 yards off the right side is Khalid Thomas. Ryan Duxworth, big defensive tackle out of Sosa, Mississippi, was there on the tackle.
And what you're going to get from any team that's coached by Brian Jenkins is if they can run the football on you, they will run the football on you. When he was at Bethune-Cookman, they led the conference in rushing year after year, trying to establish that type of tenacity on the offensive line in Montgomery now for Alabama State.
Thomas, once again, very short gain, this time off the left side as he tries to cut it back. Gets it close to the 45-yard line of the Bulldogs. Embrell Vaughn was one of those who brought him down. So it'll be a third and five for the Hornets at the 45-yard line.
And this is where you have to take advantage of it. Don't let this game fall into a lull. That's what Alabama A&M wants. You have them on the ropes up by seven. You need to convert this crucial third down to keep this drive going.
Toppings, quick throw, quick in route. He was looking for his receiver on the near side, and it is incomplete because he was trying to find Austin Bemis.
I thought that could have been pass interference. Defensive back seemed like he was clearly there before the football. Might have got away with one. And once again, see, this type of game, if you're the team that's supposed to be the favorite, you got them down 7-0, get them to 14-0, get them to 17-0, keep it going. Don't allow Alabama and them to hang around to think that they have hope at winning this football game.
A little rugby-style kick on the punt that time by Trevor Benson. It will roll dead.
Impact players for this side of the ball.
25-yard punt there, rolls dead right at the 20-yard line, just outside of it. Impact players on the opposite sides of the ball for the Alabama A&M offense and the Alabama State defense.
Well, they're going to have to run the ball. Somebody has to step up and give some help to D'Angelo Ballard. That's got to be Jordan Bentley, the freshman running back who has over 500 yards rushing this season. And for Alabama State, they want to clog the run. So they need their senior, Roderick Henderson, to be the big man in the middle of the field.
Off the play fake, quick pass to the near side. Driven out of bounds after the catch and run for nice yardage. Is Marcellus Clash. Caught that ball and picked up about 8 on the play. It'll be second and short.
And one of the things that Coach Spady believes in at Alabama A&M is the pistol offense. The coach at the University of Nevada under Chris Ault, where they perfected the pistol. He believes in the pistol, but it's yet to really take off in Huntsville.
Bentley, some room off the right side, gets the edge, and has easy first down yardage. Picks up 6 out to the 25-yard line.
Yeah, and this is a great job by the offensive line of Alabama A&M, really securing the edge and the perimeter. There was a lot of daylight there for Jordan Bentley. Chaz Wilson and Austin Simmons winning their battle at the line of scrimmage. That's something to watch for, to see if they can continue to have success running to that side of the line.
Coach James Spady talked about his freshman halfback earlier and said it doesn't look like he's going anywhere really, but by the end of the day, he's up near 100 yards rushing. Deep pass down the side, caught. Some room across the far side of the field. Inside the 20 and inside the 15-yard line is the big tight end, Kalias Robertson, a converted wide receiver who turned that catch and run into big yardage, gains 52 on that.
It's not the way you draw it up, but you ever play sandlot football there?
Absolutely.
That was a great sandlot play there. Just scramble around, make something happen. Look at all the white jerseys that are in the vicinity, but nobody goes to the receiver making the catch. Did a good job of turning up field for the play for the Bulldogs.
Coach Beatty likes his trio of tight ends here. And there's the pass, and he swung it for the intended receiver, Tevin McKenzie, who just, that one hit him in the worst spot in the hands. He was running before he had that one.
Coming out of the backfield, and that little extended handoff there. But these are the things that you have to convert. You got the big play. So right now you're thinking, we need to take some shots at the end zone. We don't want to settle for a field goal. An aggressive passing game is figuring out ways to get to the end zone, not 3 or 4 yards at a time.
Ballard buys time. Now he's going to keep it. And he slides down inside the 10, but they're going to mark it where he starts the slide. So he picked up 4. It'll be spotted at about the 11, or just outside the 10-yard line to set up third down.
A little bit of hesitancy in Ballard in terms of determining when to run the football. I thought that running lane was there open and should have picked up more than just 4 yards. Possibly could have scored had he made a quicker decision on when to run the football.
Now we have a timeout on the field.
We'll take it with them. 7.
And we're going to take 6, a break with them as both 5, teams talk it over. A&M is inside the red zone. We'll be back.
2-1.
Your flight has been delayed another 2 hours.
Mom, this is the worst vacation ever.
Ninja Turtles for you.
Yeah.
Girl Meets World for you. Golf tournament for you. And Real Housewives for you.
But this is live.
That's right. I just downloaded the free DirecTV app.
Would have been nice to have this an hour ago.
What are you streaming, hon?
How to Get Away with Murder.
The free DirecTV app. Just download and watch. It's your TV. Take it with you.
Let's make some noise.
Hold on to something!
The best action movie of the year is on Blu-ray. Star Trek Beyond on Blu-ray and digital HD now.
Back at Legion Field here in Birmingham, Alabama, the pageantry of what is the Magic City Classic. More than 60,000 expected inside the stadium here at Legion Field, and more than 100,000 outside for this spectacle of college football, one of its biggest. And on the rollout pass, he does find his tight end, Jonathan Dorsey, does D'Angelo Ballard, picked up 3 on that play. So it'll set up a fourth down.
Take the points. You have to kick the field goal. And that's why I talked about when they have the big play, you have to stay aggressive to take shots at the end zone. Think about it. They got the first down on the 15-yard line. They ran 3 plays. Not one went into the end zone. One behind the line of scrimmage, another for a 3-yard gain. So you have to think a little bit more aggressively in this type of game with your season in the balance.
Nick Carden, 8 of 9 on field goal attempts this season, and that one is right through the uprights. So Nick Carden, the 6'3", 190-pound junior out of Huntsville, Alabama, one of the homegrown products for Alabama A&M, puts them on the board with three. Schedule of events, but it has been a busy week. Classic pep rally took place on Thursday. Of course, about 1,000 of those RVs were already here already by then. Magic City Classic Parade was at 8 a.m., then the Coors Light pregame tailgate, the Ford tailgate, everybody tailgate. Alabama State and A&M again. Ho-hum.
That's the game. Somewhere in the middle there's a game.
Halftime, we have our celebrity ambassador, Ludacris, who's going to perform for everybody after that, a major recording artist. And, of course, the post-game concert, which we spoke about, featuring the man, Ludacris.
And I played in the golf tournament.
Yes, right.
Golf tournament on Thursday, so it's something for everybody.
And normally you'd be right in the middle of this with an RV of your own.
Yeah, we're not going to bring up that, but one of the best experiences I had.
I didn't mean to break your heart.
I'm disappointed. One of the best experiences I had was living here for a week. I feel like I had neighbors. So I brought my RV in on Tuesday and had my neighbors. We were having cookouts and great time in one of the most festive environments, not just in HBC football, in the country. You know, you talk to people around, they say, this is right up there with Georgia, Florida, and all those home games, Tennessee, Florida, all those SEC games. They do it right down here the last weekend of October.
Alan Rios, the kickoff, Graham and Beckwith back deep to receive, and this is Graham. Trying to get around the corner to the outside, gets it close to the 25-yard line, call it the 24 on the return. And Alabama State's Hornets will take over first and 10 with 4:14 to go in the first quarter. Along with Jay Walker, Eric Clemens, and I'm trying not to be overwhelmed by this all. I mean, both coaches talked about it for their players. Don't be overwhelmed by it, but it's almost impossible not to be.
And I like the perspective the coaches had on it. So I asked Coach Spady, you didn't know what you were getting into when you went to your first classic, did you? He said, no, they tell you about it, and they try and describe it, but it overwhelms you. Then, you know, Brian Brink Jenkins, who could be a lot laid back for Alabama State, what'd you think? Was it bigger than you thought last year? He said, Jay, I thought I'd seen it all, because he coached in the Florida classic.
Right.
He said, there's nothing like this. You have to prepare for it, and it can be a distraction if you're not focused.
And they give around the far side. Khalid Thomas trying to get the corner, but he's stacked up. And then still, they finally blow it dead as he's fighting for extra yardage down there around the left side. He picked up three on that one by the time he was said and done. And again, here's another guy who's added some weight and some strength. He's listed at 170, but they say he's now playing around 190.
Yeah, it's been interesting to watch him go through his progression. That Alabama State came in as a slasher type scat back runner, really merge into a great runner that can really hurt you from so many positions on the football field.
And here's Toppings on the keeper, plenty of room. He's got one man to beat. Quintez Toppings, touchdown. 73 yards.
And a great job of finishing the run by Quintez Toppings. Watch the safety in the middle of your field, number 14. Come up right here. Once he misses that tackle, it becomes a foot race to the end zone. Poor angle by Tyler Brown, playing free safety. And Toppin showing the athleticism to finish off the run in the end zone. That's how you put away a team that's your in-state rival in the Magic City Classic.
Boy, once he got to the second level, he hit a second gear. With Terrence Toppin, 73 yards on the run. The extra point is right through the uprights. And a two-play 76-yard drive takes only 49 seconds. Capped by Quintez Toppings, who came into the game with over 200 yards rushing and four TDs. Give him five rushing TDs on the season right now and give Alabama State an impressive 11-point lead at 14-3 with 3:25 to go here in the first.
Zone read and great decision. Look at all the attention Thomas gets. Three tacklers go towards Thomas. Toppings makes the free safety miss. It becomes a foot race. They would outrun the cornerback, Devontae Simon, who was giving it all he had, but ran out of real estate. That's a great play by QT, as they call him.
QT.
Now you're starting to see Brian Jenkins' philosophy emerge. Thomas starting to run the football. They're leading the SWAT, something that he did when he was in the Mid-East Athletic Conference. Always led the conference in rushing. So they're trying to get some things going. It's just, think the story for Alabama State was what happened when they went to Baton Rouge. We know Southern's a good football team, but for Southern to beat them the way they did, what was that score?
64-6.
That's the worst loss that Brian Jenkins' coach ball club has ever had. He told me after that game, every position on the depth chart win the competition. He opened it all up. He said, anybody can win. If you think you should play, now's your chance, and the practices have gotten more intense, and we're starting to see a much better Hornet football team.
Harvey Harris and Odarius Williams back deep to receive this kickoff. He comes down at the three. Trying to get a wall along the near side. There is a flag down, however, and some room out across the 30 is Odarius Williams, but there's a flag way back at the 7-yard line. I think they'll bring this one back.
It was close. When I saw it in live action, it looked like it might have been a block in the back, but it was close early in the return. They were trying to set up the return left.
By the way, that was Quinteris Topping's career-long run. His previous was 37 yards. That one, 73.
Fouls on the play. Illegal formation on the kicking team. Illegal block in the back. Good return on the return team, number 35. Those penalties offset. Replay the kick.
So two flags on the play. I don't know exactly where the second one was. We did see the first flag down. I don't see the second infraction.
But that would have been, well, they called it
the illegal formation,
so it would have been in the back, behind formation. And they have too many people on one side of the ball. That's one of the college football things they're talking about. So you see Coach Jenkins, and I'll be talking to those players or one of the officials saying, hey, we have five and five on each side of the ball. And, you know, I've probably seen Brian Jenkins smile maybe three times in my life. And is he smiling? Now, when he gets the intensity like that, now I take that like that's his smile.
He is as intense as they come, and he admits it. He readily admits it. But he says now, with some things he's been through in his career, he opens up every now and then and lets people see a little bit more of the real him. So he says, I mean, we had a nice conversation by phone the other day and talked about 20, 30 minutes, and he opened up a little bit. But he's still Coach Jenkins, though. I mean, he didn't give me a whole lot about what they were going to do.
He didn't say you could call me Brian. Yeah, I still want you to call him Coach. Huh?
Well, Trevor Vincent about to kick this one deep as they replay with the offsetting penalties. Harvey Harris and Odarius Williams back to receive again. And this is Harvey Harris, who feels it right at his one. Cuts it back. Has some room across the 20. And he gets up across the 25 to the 26-yard line. Some nice footwork on that return by Harvey Harris. And let's see if Alabama A&M, we have another flag down on the play. No, we do not. Okay. So it's out there at the 26-yard line where Alabama A&M will take over.
Good shot there, number 32 in white, Courtney Berry. You know, he came into the season for Alabama State, one of the leading tacklers in school history. And preseason defensive player of the year in the SWAC, but been bit by the injury bug a little bit. And hasn't put up the type of productivity he has in prior years, but still one of the best linebackers in FCS football. Senior, four-year starter at Alabama State, and you know he wants to go out with a bang.
And turning the corner, this time it looks like Harvey Harris, and Harris had a lot of room once he got that corner. 25 yards on the pickup around the near left side. And they'll get that ball across midfield of the 49-yard line of Alabama State before he's pushed out of bounds. And we get some movement inside. Looked like big Roderick Henderson. And a guy going a little early, but was he drawn off?
Offside. 94, defense with contact, 5-yard penalty, first down.
And I like to say when you're 6'1", 350 pounds, when you move early, the whole stadium knows it was you.
Alabama State penalties have been a problem. That was their 67th penalty, the this season. That's the fifth most in FCS. Of course, Coach Jenkins wants to get that straightened out. And looking for the tight end, Jonathan Dorsey, that time was D'Angelo Ballard, and that was off his hands incomplete. Maybe a little bit behind him.
Yeah, behind him, you know, he needs to make the catch, but as a quarterback, I mean, that's a five-yard route in the flat. You're supposed to hit that every day, all day, twice on Sundays, as we like to say it. That's why, you know, D'Angelo Ballard is a 47% passer, below 50%, because the easy throws he misses. And he just like to see him get more consistent, throwing the football accurately.
Now it escapes some pressure that time. He's going to keep it. And he gets first down yardage, depending on the spot. That's going to be inside the 40 to the 39-yard line. That's right at the first down marker. I think they'll move the sticks on that one, again, depending on the spot.
Well,
they're going to measure.
And he made the extension. He saw it was great awareness by Ballard, knowing where the first down marker was. And I thought his extension clearly gave him the first down. Who was that right there? He wants every inch, every yard. He's trying to manipulate the chain game. Come on, Coach Jenkins. But he's telling him, I saw a kink in there. Hold on, give me a couple extra links.
That is a first down by the nose of the football, literally.
And that was good awareness by D'Angelo Ballard. Not throwing the ball as accurately as he would like, but he can run the football, and that was a good football presence to extend and get the first down.
Both these teams like to grind it out, keep it on the ground with their quarterbacks and running backs. They're the one and two teams in terms of first downs per game as well. Both of them average over 20 first downs a game. So we'll see as this one develops. Which offense maintained some ball control? Nice breaking of the tackle that time by Jonathan Dorsey. He didn't really hit down after he was initially contacted to pick up of 7 yards. Nice balance and effort on that play. And it'll set up second down and short.
And this is the lull in the action. This is supposed to be an exciting, up-tempo offense. You know, I'd hurry up and call plays rapid fire while you have that Alabama State defense on the field. You're putting together a good drive, get to the line of scrimmage and get the ball snapped.
Going for it all, end zone, and a little bit overthrown. Also a little bit to the left of his intended receiver, Ladarian Heath. And back there in coverage was Ronnie Scott.
And I like the way you said it, just off a little bit to his left. The key is if that's a more accurately thrown ball, that's a touchdown. This is a wide receiver that gets in the middle of the field behind his defender, but the throw is off target. If you throw it to the inside, that's a touchdown. And those are the plays that you have to make if you want to have a successful passing game in college football.
Bulldogs 1-for-4 on third down so far in the game. Little swing pass, a one-handed catch. A nice one at that, but met immediately in the backfield was the receiver for a loss of 7. And that'll create a fourth down situation and long. Met by Joshua Hill, number 43, right in the backfield. He sniffed that one out early.
And you see where the frustration is? They had a touchdown route open. Instead, they missed that. So instead of having this a 14-10 game, now 14-3, you're getting ready to punt. And Alabama State's going to have an opportunity to expand their lead.
Nick Carden set to punt it deep to Khalid Thomas, who's already made his presence felt in the return game. And Thomas signaling fair catch and properly lets it bounce inside the 10-yard line, but a favorable bounce for A&M as it bounces back toward the field of play, and it'll be downed at the 7-yard line, where Alabama State will take over first and 10, up by 11 within the last minute of the opening quarter. 75th Magic City Classic. And
Happy classic.
You know, I tell you what, a lot of people might be happy here, too. All that food that we saw outside.
Oh, yeah.
You know how people get when they have a lot of food. At least I do.
What does that do?
They
makes
get
you happy?
Tired. Happy
you get tired.
And tired, and you don't feel like cheering. I remember seeing the legendary group Earth, Wind, and Fire one Thanksgiving Day. It was the dullest crowd ever because we were all full, eating all our turkey, and we couldn't rock with Earth, Wind, and Fire. It was crazy. Anyway, I digress. Alabama State taking over. Toppings gives it to Thomas, who spins out across the 10-yard line to the 11. That was actually Alex Anderson, one of Khalid Thomas's backups, number 5, who carried that ball in there. Correction there.
You know, that next generation, just the sophomore from Miami Gardens, doing a good job in backing up Khalid Thomas, preparing for the future.
Alex Anderson again, this time he is no room whatsoever on what very well could be the final play of the first quarter, as Demarius Williams was one of those in on the tackle, pick number 92. Stopping in there as we're within the final 10 seconds of the quarter. And I don't think they're going to get another playoff here on third down and 9. So that is the end of the first quarter. Alabama State struck with a couple of big plays. They're out to a 14-3 lead here in the first quarter of the Magic City Classic here at Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama. Back with the second quarter action in just a moment.
3, 2, 1.
From now until the end of the year,
shopping small could be even more rewarding.
Because when you shop at a small business,
you could get 2 times the rewards.
Learn more and enroll online today at AmericanExpress.com. Get together and shop small.
Zaxby's flavor brings everyone together.
Even rivals.
Start of the second quarter here at Legion Field. They come from all over. They bring the RVs, they bring the tents, they bring the grills, they bring the food, and you bring your appetite. And if you didn't know about Classic Week before today, now you know. I certainly know. This is my initial one. What a spectacle. It has been a wonderful time the last few days out here in Birmingham, Alabama. Alabama State continuing their march. Third down and 9. Topping's going to keep it, and I think he's going to be brought down about 2 yards short of first down yardage as he picks up 5. Embrell Vaughn was the guy who brought him down a little short of the first down. Big stop there by Alabama A&M. Now they can get the ball back, maybe in pretty good field position after this punt.
They take advantage of it. The special teams did a good job of pinning Alabama State inside the 10-yard line. The defense made the stop. Now don't do anything silly like get a holding penalty on this return or running into the kicker. Just take a solid return, try and get the ball past the 50-yard line, and then hopefully your offense can wake up and put some more points on the board.
Rashad Anderson back deep to field this punt from Trevor Vincent. Anderson telling everybody to get away from it. It is down at the 45-yard line, so excellent field position for Alabama A&M and hopefully for Coach Spady. They get something started.
But that's a mistake. They set up punt return. Right, they didn't even rush the punter. So the number one thing you have to do as a return man is field it. Don't let the punt hit the ground. He let the ball hit the ground, took a bounce, and they didn't get what they should have gotten. I mean, that's just the little things that separate the really good teams and the teams that are still struggling to find their way and can't get out of the way of themselves.
40-yard punt, of course, no return on that one, as Alabama A&M will take over. At its own 45-yard line. Quick wide receiver hit on the near side, and he'll be pushed out at the 49-yard line of Alabama State after a pickup of 6. Dominic Jackson pushed out Ladarian Heath after the catch.
I'd like to see them establish they can run the football a little bit more. Everybody likes the extended handoffs, the wide receiver bubble screens, but I thought they started showing some success running off tackle, outside the tackle box with their running game.
I think that play is still good, as keeping it was D'Angelo Ballard, but we got flags on the play. It looked like an Alabama State interior lineman moved early and was in the neutral zone at the time of the snap.
See Spady taking advantage of the quarterback running out of bounds. And the penalty gets to talk to him and get the next play in.
Coach Spady says his quarterback, his senior quarterback, is improved 180 over the last three games.
55, defense, 5-yard penalty.
You got to look.
First down.
Full starter frozen in point.
Let's see. Garrett Oden right here, which he shouldn't have this penalty because the ball is right in front of him. But you see, he's moving around and got caught.
And the quarterback keeper. And this time Ballard gets it inside the 40 to the 39-yard line, picked up five.
Now that's the difference in today's dual-threat quarterbacks and quarterbacks, you know, the drop-back passers. I didn't want you calling quarterback sweep. Because you call a quarterback sweeping to the boundary, more than likely I'm going to get hit. And you're supposed to be the running game. You know, if I want to run on my own, that's fine. But you call a quarterback sweep, coach, you don't mind if I get hit, do you?
Second and five, Ballard. Looking wide open on the far side as his receiver gets it inside the 25, brought down at the 24-yard line. As L moved the chains that time after a gain of 15 yards. As Tevin McKenzie made the catch on the far side of the field.
And this is why I like the direction of which head coach Spady's starting to go. We've seen receivers open. I just think once he finds a trigger man and Ballard can be more consistent with the throws, they'll see a lot of improvement in offensive production for Alabama A&M.
And another play call from the sideline as the offense looks over. Nice leading on the little wide receiver screen pass there, Tevin McKenzie, but he only was able to pick up two because of a nice open field tackle, or he might have had a lot more.
Oh, great job by Ronnie Scott playing the cornerback position. Not only did he fight off the block, but made a tackle from his knees to minimize the yards picked up on that play. Good job, Ronnie Scott, Jr. from Tampa, Florida.
Second and eight. And this is Bentley wide open up the middle. He had a huge lane. Nobody touched him. Touchdown, Jordan Bentley. And the true freshman puts it in from 22 yards away. And more importantly, Alabama A&M, just like that, is right back in the game.
In the vision. Watch the hop step here. Sees the hole, makes a nice little hop step, then gets back north and south quickly. Good-looking freshman running back in Jordan Bentley right down the road from Huntsville in Guntersville, Alabama.
Nick Carden going to come on for the extra point. Coach Beatty and I talked about Bentley, and he says he kind of, if you had to try to compare him to an NFL back, it might be a Matt Forte type. Doesn't look like he's going very fast, but he picks up yardage effective on that play to put A&M back in the game.
4-3.
ESPNU College Football is brought to you by Devour, new in the freezer section. It's food you want to fork.
It's okay. You're only on national television.
You know that moment when you spot a pattern? When that key indicator leaps off the screen and says, "Take a look at me." When an idea you validated looks you square in the eye and says, "Let's do this." Welcome to the new Scottrade. Whether you know where you're going or need guidance to get there, we're here to help. Now is your moment.
Earlier today, Magic City Classic Parade here in Birmingham, Alabama, part of the many festivities which make up Magic City Classic Weekend here in Birmingham. And for supporters of Alabama A&M, a little bit more to be happier about after that 5-play, 55-yard march ends in the Jordan Bentley 22-yard touchdown run to put the Bulldogs back in the game. Deron Presley, one of those back deep to receive this kickoff just outside his 10-yard line. Kickoff coming off the foot of Alan Rios. And this one's short. And breaking into the open across the 40. Good field position for Alabama State as Palmer Graham brings it out to the 43-yard line after a return of 26 yards on the play. So Alabama State's going to see if it can answer after giving up that quick touchdown to A&M to allow the Bulldogs to get back into the ballgame within four with 11:33 to go here in the first half.
And that's what you have to do. You got a rivalry-type game, and you don't continue to put your opponent away. You let them hang around. They get one big play, pick up a little momentum, and then you find yourself in a toughly contested football game. But I think both coaches knew, you know, coming into this game, that neither team was going to give up and quit, and it's going to be hard fought all the way to the end.
And Quinteris Toppin's going to keep off the play fake, going deep, and it's incomplete.
And, you know, we're going to have some interesting things to talk about. I'll have my top five Magic City Classic moments in the 10 or 12 years I've been covering this game. But I'm going to add one to it right now. This is the hottest Magic City Classic I've ever been to. I mean, it's October. What is it?
It's 80, warm.
87,
it's in
88
the 80s,
degrees?
I think.
Look, they're fanning. It's hot.
Yeah, especially in the sun.
And that side over there where Alabama State is, those players have been standing in that sun for all game, where there's plenty of shade on the Alabama A&M side.
And Thomas, big hole up the middle. Thomas inside the 45 before he's finally brought down at the 42-yard line. A pickup of 14, move the sticks for Alabama State. He was brought down by Mike Mills in the secondary.
See the difference? When State gets a big play, they get up to the line of scrimmage. They want to get this ball snapped to wear down the defense.
Nigel Lee on the quick wide receiver swing pass. And Nigel Lee fighting off tackles, getting it close to the 35-yard line. Give him eight on that play before Adrian Portlock knocked him out of bounds.
And that's so important to do that, because we saw the big run by Thomas. And then you get the ball snapped again. Even on a wide receiver screen, the defensive linemen have to chase from the inside. So that's how you wear out a football team, make them go north and south and east and west.
Lee Thomas picking his way through a hole and gets first down yardage before he's stacked up and driven a bit backwards, but he's going to be down at the 31-yard line, and they'll move the chains once again for Alabama State. So this team answering after the defense gives up a quick touchdown to Alabama A&M and moving the ball in a steady march downfield.
Yeah, so far, good response, and I really like the play selection by offensive coordinator Mark Orlando from Alabama State. Keeping the pressure on Alabama A&M's defensive line, trying to wear them out.
Darryl King going off the right side that time. And he was able to pick up maybe four on the first down play. Call it three. And they have upped the tempo a little bit. They're getting right back to the line of scrimmage quickly. And a little movement along the right side. Might have been Big Sam Baptiste, number 74.
Second down.
6'4", 340-pound senior. It's the sixth offensive line combination that Coach Brian Jenkins has used this season. He's got a very versatile and experienced offensive line. And we've seen some shades of them opening up big holes for Khalid Thomas and company so far here in the first half.
After the loss to Southern, every position was up for grabs. If you were a backup, you had an opportunity to try and compete for the starting job. And it's been a much better football team since that moment.
Avery Giles there to meet Khalid Thomas. As soon as he got that one, he'll lose a couple on that play and set up third and long. So just as we talk about the drive going downfield and them sustaining a march, a penalty, a loss of yards, and now they are faced with a big third down. He fights off the block and makes a nice tackle there. Big number 95, the 6'1", 345-pound junior from Libran, Georgia. Wide open on the near side, Nigel Lee. Lee tries to hurdle a tackler and does. and gets inside the 30, down to about the 27-yard line. He'll be well short of the first down, but that'll make the highlight reels.
Yeah, but he got tagged. And this is why you tell young ball carriers, not a lot of good things happen when you leave your feet. So he's going to go over the cornerback, but watch the finishing blow. Bam! Right in the back. Good shot delivered by the Alabama A&M safety coming over to make that hit.
He hurdled Devontae Simon, and then Adrian Portlock came in to clean up with the tag in the back.
And that's going to hurt tomorrow. So highlight film, yes, but tomorrow when you're in the training room and your back's a little sore, you're going to know why.
Trevor Vincent going to punt that one down and gets a nice dead roll, if you will. It's going to be down to inside the 5-yard line, so an excellent job on that rugby-style kick by Trevor Vincent. And it rolls dead at the 4-yard line. Alabama A&M will take over, backed up in the shadow of its own goalposts when we get back.
You know that moment? The moment it hits you. Seems like yesterday she was born, and tomorrow she'll be off to college. Let that sink in for a moment. Then come see us. Welcome to the new Scott Trade. For us, every chair is a beach chair.
Back here in the historic Birmingham, Alabama, that's the Birmingham Civil Rights Institute. It was recently named a top 10 national historic site. Of course, this city at the very forefront of the African-American civil rights struggle in the 50s and 60s. The infamous church bombing not far from this site. The infamous Bull Connor with the hoses. I mean, a lot of people made a lot of sacrifices to fight for freedom and equality here in Birmingham, Alabama.
And I think Birmingham is turning it around.
Yep.
You know, a lot of healing taking place here in the downtown Birmingham is really starting to show signs of life, economic development, cultural diversity. I've seen the city kind of change over the years I've been covering this football game, and it's been a change for the better.
And we get some movement on the interior once again. And this time Garrett Oden might have jumped a little bit early. So that might
practice
give.
Snap. False start. 34 offense. Half the distance to the goal. First down.
So he was drawn off, as I was about to say. It might give the Bulldogs a little bit more room. Roderick Randolph, backup tight end, was the one who moved. They use him at the H-back spot a lot. That guy comes from an athletic pedigree. His brother, older brother in the NBA, younger brother, a top offensive line recruit. And there he is, one of the tight ends. And look at the footwork of Jordan Bentley, the freshman. Gets good yardage outside the 5. He picked up 7 on that play. Get it out to about the 8-yard line, make it the 9. Ballard getting the official call from the sideline now. This is where you might expect to see more of the freshman sensation Bentley. Coach Beatty calls sneaky again. Kind of doesn't look like he's doing much. Picked up 3 that time, but the pile seems to always go forward. And by the end of the game, he's somewhere around 100 yards rushing.
And that's what you want. Good running backs have great forward momentum. So even when there's contact, they still manage to scrape 2 or 3 yards after the initial hit. Bentley showing the uncanny ability of a freshman to be able to pick up those type of yards.
3rd and 2. Coach Beatty says if he's healthy, no question about it, he will break every school record rushing the football in Alabama A&M.
I don't know, you need to remind Coach Spade about a young guy by the name of Fred Lester.
Oh, he knew about him. He just said this guy is going to break those records if he's healthy.
Easy.
He knew all about it.
Easy.
Prior to the snap, false start, 34, offense, 5-yard penalty, 3rd down.
Second Roderick time. Randolph, yeah, having a little trouble on this drive, getting the snap count.
particularly when they're just trying to get it a first down so they can win the battle of field position. He's not helping the cause, but you know, going back to Bentley, I like Bentley. Great vision. Mm-hmm. You know, anytime you average over 5.5 yards per carry as a freshman, you've got some tools. But a lot of football needs to be played. And I think more importantly, they need to get more talent on the offensive line for him to have any chance of breaking those records at A&M.
Running out and going deep down the sideline. Has his receiver behind the defender. And a sensational stretched out catch that time by Ladarian Heath. What an effort.
And, you know, I've got to call it like I see it. Fantastic pass by D'Angelo Ballard. Gave him a hard time for ball location early on some of the throws. This ball was thrown perfectly with the quick release. Sets up and lets it go, knowing he's going to get hit. Look at the location of that ball. I don't know if you can throw it any better than D'Angelo Ballard did on that play there.
46 yards on that hookup, crossing midfield to the 47-yard line. Ballard going deep this time again, but underthrows everybody as he was once again looking for Ladarian Heath, this time on the far side.
We talk about the ability to move the football down there, and if you have an accurate passer, then your wide receivers tend to work a little bit harder to get open for you. It becomes contagious.
Second and 10 after that incompletion. That one woke the crowd up a little bit, that diving effort that time by Ladarian Heath. Going deep downfield again. And he overshot his man once again. Ladarian Heath this time over the left shoulder.
And this is what we say, you know, if you want to be an accurate passer, and the numbers never lie most times, right? 47% passer. Threw a great pass on the deep one to Heath. And then just threw a ball 3 yards out of bounds and 5 yards too far ahead. Where's the accuracy? You have to stay consistent. I've never seen the sideline make a great catch. You have to keep the ball in play so your receivers can at least attempt to help you.
Bulldogs are 2 of 6 so far in the game on third down. So they can keep this one alive on a big 3rd and 10 from the 47-yard line of Alabama State. Showing blitz, in trouble, and down he goes. D'Angelo Ballard was first bothered by the blitzing Mike linebacker, Courtney Berry, and he got a little help bringing him down. It'll be a slight loss on the play. Call it a quarterback sack. He lost one, so it'll set up 4th down. And it looks like A&M's going to punt it away with Nick Carden.
See, both teams just picking up enough first downs like we knew they would. You said they'd get more first downs than anybody in conference. And making this a battle of field position. And now Alabama A&M with an opportunity to try and pin Alabama State deep in their own territory.
With Alabama State man.
Referee asked the Alabama State fan to stop playing, and that was the first warning. Khalid Thomas standing at his 15-yard line, back deep to receive this punt from Nick Carden. End over end punt, fair catch signaled and caught right there at the 14-yard line where Alabama State will take over. We'll be back as the second quarter continues in just a moment.
You're gonna need one big push. You got one more? Here we go.
Congrats! I hear you're having a baby.
You better just breathe. Here we go.
You better start saving for college tuition. And you'll probably need a bigger house at some point. But New York Life can help you manage your family's financial future. So you can relax and enjoy life's special moments. Like this moment. That's what being good at life is all about, right?
Be good at life. New York Life.
Work for it, work for it. Come on now. You ready to quit? Tired? Good. You think this is her? the warm-up. Playtime's up. Let's do it again.
Back here at Legion Field in Birmingham, we're taking a look at the standings in the East and Western divisions of the SWAC. Alcorn State appearing to have an inside track and an appearance in the SWAC championship, but the West kind of up for grabs.
Yeah, but when you talk to folks at Alabama State, they feel like if we win the rest of our games, then they'll make it to the SWAC championship, and that can happen. They still have to play Jackson State, I believe. They still have to play Grambling, those schools there. So if they can win out, then I believe they've got a chance.
Juwan Young battle in the game now at quarterback, number 10. And gives it that time to Khalid Thomas, who has first down yardage and more as he battles up to close to the 30-yard line around the far side.
And this is a case where they're not taking Toppings out of the game because of his performance. It's just something that Brian Jenkins has always done. He likes having a backup quarterback that can play and run the offense just in case an injury happens to a starting quarterback.
He said that he would insert him into certain situations for a change of pace throughout this game. That time the handoff goes to Khalid Thomas, and he loses a couple yards trying to go off the right side. Call it 3 yards on the loss. And so it'll be second and 13.
And it has to be a little bit disappointing that the weakness of A&M has been their defense, one of the worst defenses in FCS football. They give up 36 points a game. They give up almost 200 yards rushing per game, and they have 250 yards passing. But yet, you know, it seems like this Alabama State offense has kind of stalled, and they figured them out a little bit.
Marquell Beckwith showing some nice moves as he gets out across the 30 to about the 31. He picked up 6 on that run before he was brought down. That time by Demarius Williams, the big defensive tackle, senior out of Shaw, Mississippi. So a big third down coming to try to keep this drive alive for Juwan Young Battle. He's completing 50% of his passes coming into this game, and injuries took him out of what was earlier in the season a quarterback merry-go-round, if you will, for head coach Brian Jenkins. But his injuries opened the door for Quinteris Toppings to assume control of that number one job right now. We have a timeout on the field with 2:59 to go here in the first half.
Take a break with him.
And we'll come back. We'll take a break. Continue here. Late second quarter action. The 75th Magic City Classic from Birmingham, Alabama.
There are a few who move toward the sounds of chaos. Forged in the crucible of training, they are the first to move toward the sounds of tyranny, injustice, and despair. They are the few, the proud, the Marines.
At us now, Deontay. Heavyweight champion of the world, Deontay Wilder. Okay, that's more like it. He gives a peace sign.
From right here in Birmingham, right here. Alabama. But I really like, he's hosted fights here in Birmingham because he wanted to fight in front of his home crowd. Made a little bit less money, but.
Young Battle, all kinds of green in front of him as he escapes the rush and rolls out to the left side. And he gets that ball out to midfield, and nobody was within 5 yards of him when he turned that corner. He picked up 19.
And coming off of a timeout, which is disappointing, and they allow the quarterback to pick up the first down and then some. The reason why this defense gives up 445 yards per game in total offense.
The empty backfield now for the junior quarterback, Juwan Young Battle. Trying to buy some time, now going deep down the near side, and I think the receiver stepped out of bounds. You see the black hat, maybe you saw it come in. But the side judge threw it in there, meaning the receiver stepped out of bounds before he caught it. He was looking for Joe Williams, the 6'1 redshirt sophomore out of Fort Myers. and you'll see Joe step out.
Yep.
Can't do that.
And you have to know where you're on the football field. I mean, that's something there where it's your responsibility as a wide receiver to not run out of bounds before you make the catch. A little bit too much momentum, not able to stop, and turns out being just an incompletion. Tell you what, I kind of like what I'm seeing here in Young Battle. They brought a blitzing linebacker from the edge. He didn't panic, froze the outside linebacker in his tracks, and still kept his vision downfield to make a good throw.
And Young Battle keeps this one after the fake to Beckwith, who came across in motion in front of him, and he picked up 6 yards on the play, so it was another big third down as we approach the 2-minute mark here in the first half of the 75th Magic City Classic here from Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama. And what's Coach Jenkins got up his sleeve right now on 3rd and 4?
You want to keep possession of the football, gain the first down so you can ensure you're going to have the last possession of the first half. And Alabama A&M won't get the ball back with a chance to chip away into this lead. But I still think it's a pretty conservative play call. Probably give Young Battle and Khalid Thomas some type of run play action in the backfield.
Timeout on the field as Coach Spady and Alabama A&M want to talk things over. Big third down play for the opponent with a minute 46 to go here in the half. Of course, Coach Spady would like to end that drive here and get the ball back and run his less than 2-minute offense, see if he can get closer in this ball game, trailing by 4. Alabama State getting off to an early start. A couple of big touchdown runs. Thomas and the quarterback, Quinteris Toppings. But Alabama A&M coming back with a nice 22-yard touchdown run by Jordan Bentley to get within 4.
See the place filling up?
Filling up.
And I always told you, if you want to see almost maximum capacity, look about a minute and a half before a halftime show. Because the bands, everybody's going to come in and see halftime. And what's unique about this venue is people are constantly walking around the stadium. But once halftime takes place, they all want to go to their seats and watch the show that's going to take place between these two great marching bands.
And the rivalry there between the marching bands is just as intense as it is on the football field as their two teams go at it. In battle, quarterback draw, plenty of room inside the 30-yard line and down about the 26. As nobody's paying a lot of attention to Juwan Young Battle, he picked up 17 that time.
This is a little freeze draw. Did you see his footwork in the backfield on that one? Got the snap and just stood still and then took off running. So
you run your share of those in your days at
back in the day, it's kind of, you don't see those too often.
Okay.
Nowadays.
All right. That's a polite way of saying no.
Yeah, well, you know. If I run it, when you could throw it as good as I could.
Okay, there you go. Throws that one downfield, kind of up for grabs, and luckily that one's incomplete out of the end zone and out of bounds, but a couple of flags down around where Juwan Young Battle threw the football. He was looking for Lalia McCary in the end zone. See how they sort this one out. A little trouble hearing the microphone of the referee that time, but a holding penalty.
Right there, you see number 72, Edward Sanders, the guard. Has a handful of jersey.
So on 1st and 20, Young Battle throwing near side into a little bit of a crowd. And Khalid Thomas knocked down immediately by Avery Giles. 345 pounds coming down on the 190-pounder. That.
And what you really like is the recognition by Giles that this is a screen play. He's a nose tackle. Realize they're setting up a screen, seeks out the ball carrier. He landed all 345 pounds on the 190-pound frame of Khalid Thomas.
So no gain on that screen play that was sniffed out. 2nd and 20, going long. Underthrew it a little bit, deflected off the hands. Is it kicked in the end zone?
Yes.
It is. Intercepted. Terrain Callaway, number 5, one of the defensive leaders back there, transferred from Nevada. Coach Spady knows him all too well and makes a big play off the deflection.
And it was great concentration. The original defensive back went up to deflect the football, and Callaway followed the ball and made a fantastic play for what appears to be an interception in the end zone. You're going to see the defensive back come from the right side of your screen. Will come in and try and get the ball at his highest point. He's not able to make the catch cleanly. I'd give it to him. Moving, but that's okay because when it was moving, he still secured the football. See, I think the kids,
Didn't touch the ground.
Yes, yeah. They're going to take that. And as we say, the SWAT, for all of its televised games, does utilize instant replay. That right there, and the fact that it moved around a little bit, is enough to say that this interception shouldn't stand.
Now, the ruling on the field was an interception and a touchback, and Coach Jenkins doesn't think so.
Well, how are they not reviewing this? Oh, wow.
And getting out of there is Ballard. Plenty of room on the far side. Ballard gets it out across the 30 to the 33-yard line. He picked up 13 on that scramble. I'm thinking we're waiting for a review on the catch, and I guess they decided that he caught it.
And Brian Jenkins was there with the official. Maybe you call a timeout in that situation to do it, but on turnovers, they should look at that play right away. I just don't know what they saw. I thought we saw, it's pretty clear that that ball touched the ground and moved after touching the ground.
Ballard keeping it again. Plenty of room again. Coming to the near side. He's got one man to beat. And they finally catch him from behind. That's a pretty late tackle out of bounds and a flag.
And comes down on the play. And what's important, that flag, the late hit, is going to add on 15 yards. So now you're in field goal range. It would have been a pretty long field goal maybe without it. But if this penalty goes against them with only 1 second left, you have a great opportunity to make this a one-point game going into the half. And what a huge change of momentum this has been the last 45 seconds here in Birmingham, Alabama.
51 yards for D'Angelo Ballard, the quarterback, a threat on the ground. Came in with 6 rushing touchdowns, 389 yards. Picked up 51 on that scramble.
Personal foul, late hit out of bounds. Defense, half the distance to the goal. First down.
Bradley Street, the fifth-year senior out of Ellenwood, Georgia, delivering the late tackle out of bounds on the quarterback.
It's just a good move, and Courtney Berry kind of takes a poor angle. Something doesn't happen too often, and great athleticism on display by Ballard. Get as much yards as he can. It's the takedown at the end that was easy to call.
Nick Carton has been perfect from this distance this year, and he continues to be perfect as that is the final play of the first half. And the Bulldogs of Alabama A&M are right back in this one. The 75th Magic City Classic is a 14-13 Alabama State lead at the half, but you have to say momentum has swung in the favor of the A&M Bulldogs. Well, the halftime festivities, just as good as the game, just as good as everything we've seen around this magical event all weekend long. 14-13 Alabama State leading at the break. The Battle of Hands, a lot more stuff for you coming back.
I'm very good at pretending.
It's this in game.
Being good at this kind of work is not very beautiful.
Is you. You enter the Cricket Wireless and ESPN Bucket List sweepstakes for a chance to win a trip to one of the year's biggest sporting events. Like this, and this, or this. And it all starts here. Visit your local cricket store or go online to enter.
2-1, we're back.
Back here at Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama, halftime of the 75th annual Magic City Classic. Alabama State with a one-point lead over Alabama A&M. Back in the booth, along with Jay Walker, I'm Eric Clemens. Again, thanking you for being with us on a magical weekend here in Birmingham,
Alabama.
Happy Classic.
Happy Classic,
brother. All right, and I'll tell you what. Again, I always say it every week. This is my favorite part of the show.
Okay.
It's time for Gimme Five, and you got five magical Magic City moments that you want to talk about.
We definitely have the memories here, but they need some passing right now. I mean,
yeah.
You know, I like see the location of the throws I'm making right there. Hitting
on
guys
the
in
run.
Stride. That's how you play the quarterback
That's
position.
Impressive.
Hitting them in stride. They need a little help, but I can't help them from up here in the booth. But let's, how about this? My best moments at the Magic City, since I've seen this classic up close and personal, I told everybody, the number one HBCU game in the country, maybe one of the best. I lived in a motorhome one year.
Mm-hmm.
From Tuesday through Sunday, I had neighbors and friends, one of the best things ever. You know what got me? When I moved in on Tuesday, I was like, I'll drop off the motorhome and then I'll go stay in the hotel.
Mm.
I said, I'm not going nowhere. I stayed here all week. It wasn't just me. There were hundreds of motorhomes out there starting on Tuesday.
All right, give me four.
Number four, Belle Biv DeVoe. You know, I grew up with that New Edition
mm-hmm.
type deal, and they had a Belle Biv DeVoe BVD post-game concert.
Wow.
And what people don't know is there's a free post-game concert in the stadium when the game's over 30 minutes after the last whistle. So they do that, and this year it's going to be who?
Ludacris.
I'm looking forward to that one. He may make the list.
All right. Give me number three.
The barbecue grill battle.
No.
Now, this game, you know, you got the world's largest cocktail party. It's called, this is the world's biggest barbecue time.
Mm.
I don't care where you go. They're cooking everything. They're cooking turkey legs, hamburger. You're starting to see pork loin, as they call it down here, lamb chops, turkey leg. So one year, we compared everybody's barbecue grill, from
uh-huh.
the biggest ones to the smallest one. These people put a lot of time and effort into their grill, and presentation is the key. We had a battle that was phenomenal.
Time now for the top two. Give me number two.
The players. I'm a football player at heart. And at the end of the day, it comes down to those young men on the field. I remember seeing Tavares Jackson dominate when he played at Alabama State. And I remember seeing Robert Mathis come out during this game. That's when they said, he's going to be a star. He's not just an average player. He's a great player. It all comes down to the players with me. You know that.
Right. Mathis, of course, had a great career as a rush defensive end slash linebacker in the National Football League. And finally, give me number one.
Can I show you number one?
Show me number one.
I got to show you number one. Everybody knows I'm an L.A. guy from L.A., California, West Side. This was my number one moment. I left the booth and said, I got to meet Cube. So after we're talking, I said, man, I'm a fan, man. Can I get some dap? He dapped me up. We shot the breeze. So me talking to Ice Cube here, yay, yay. That's my number one Magic City memory. And it's a magical thing. You need to come check it out. Your
Absolutely.
First classic. So
my first one.
A couple more years, you'll have your list. We'll
I have a
you're giving five.
Maybe mix them a bit, but you won't see me on the field making those rockets.
And on the bubble, I can't mention my I can't forget my boys. Morris Day sat right where you are right now. And I talked to Morris Day. He did us some little play-by-play as well as Bootsy Collins. And hearing Bootsy Collins introduce himself, Hubba Bubba, baby. It was awesome.
And did Morris Day say yes?
Yeah, he did. Along with other things. We thought we had to leave the air early. But that's my thoughts. If you want to talk about it, hit me up on Twitter, Jay Walker Sky.
All right. 14-13, the halftime festivities here at the Magic City Classic continue in just a few moments. We'll be back.
I have something I need you to translate for me.
Is that?
Look at all these purchases you made with your airline credit card. Hold on, you only got double miles on stuff you bought from that airline? Let me show you something better. The Capital One Venture Card. With Venture, you earn unlimited double miles on every purchase, not just airline purchases. Every purchase, everywhere, every day. No, really. Double miles on all of them. What's in your wallet?
Campbell's Chunky Everyman All-Star League.
All right, boys.
This week we got Ebron's Motown Mo Soups taking on Todd's Girly Fries.
What? I'm not good at naming things.
Well, I hope you're good at taking beatdowns, because my man Dr. Dave Beasley about to go off. Dude's a pediatrician and coaches Pee Wee football.
You know he injured, right?
Took a pass right to the gift basket.
Yikes.
No!
Campbell's Chunky Soup, the hearty way to fuel your game.
Look at all these purchases you made with your airline credit card. Hold on, you only got double miles on stuff you bought from that airline? Let me show you something better. The Capital One Venture Card. With Venture, you earn unlimited double miles on every purchase. Not just airline purchases. Every purchase, everywhere, every day. No, really, double miles on all of them. What's in your wallet?
We're back here at Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama. Eric Clements along with Jay Walker. Halftime here at the 75th Magic City Classic with Alabama State leading Alabama A&M by one. Well, we saw you give me five earlier. Now it's time for your power rankings. Another thing I look forward to. Much change in that top five? We'll see.
Well, we keep them talking. You know, keep in mind, these are my power rankings. You know, what I say is law, but that's another story right there. But
that's true.
Some competitive football being played right now. And a little interesting twist to the power rankings this week. It's the top five. How about we're going to give a tie for fourth place? Tennessee State, Prairie View A&M, both took losses last week, but they were playing up FBS team. Tennessee State had Vanderbilt on the ropes much of that game in the first half, and Prairie View A&M put up more than 30 points on Rice. So I'm going to say tie for fourth with Prairie View A&M and Tennessee State.
All right, how about number three then?
Look out, all season long, all the talk has been about the Aggies, but the Eagles keep saying, not talking about us. Malcolm Bell's injury concerns me, though, but North Carolina Central, the number three team in HBCU football.
2-1, probably fairly easy to figure out if you've been following this at all.
Well, I'll say this. Number two, right? And I saw former Grambling head coach Melvin Spears. He came by the booth, said hello. And you know what he said, Jay? The G-men are back.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if a former coach can say that the G-men are back, then the G-men are back.
Okay.
Devontae Kincaid is sensational. They're great, but they're not number one because number one,
hey,
they're trying to go wire to wire, defending HBCU national champions. They have the most dynamic weapon in all of FCS football in Tariq Cohen. North Carolina A&T is getting better and better as the week goes on. That's a scary thought for the rest of the HBCU football world.
You got anybody on the bubble this week?
Well, you got Southern. I haven't seen Southern play in a long time. They were playing at a very high level. Two straight weeks of inactivity made me bump them down off the bubble. But they're close, and I think, you know, they'll probably see him next week. I wouldn't be surprised. It's a talented team. Leonard Tillery, the running back, has an opportunity to become the SWAT all-time leading rusher. That should not be overshadowed by the fantastic accomplishments of Tariq Cohen in the Mid-East Athletic Conference. Leonard Tillery's doing the same down in the SWAT.
Tillery, the SWAT's leading rusher, of course. And we are still continuing with halftime festivities. The Battle of the Bands has begun here at the half at Legion Field. We'll return with more halftime festivities in just a few moments.
To achieve financial security, there are two halves to consider: protect and grow. Instead of focusing on insurance or investments alone, we bring them together into one whole picture. At Northwestern Mutual, we help you live life differently.
Sweden's greetings. We're bringing more merriment to the holiday season with a special offer on a brand new Volvo. Each comes equipped with standard features, like engine remote start to keep you warm this winter, and built-in Wi-Fi so you stay connected. Wherever your holiday travels may take you, get there in a brand new Volvo. It's our way of wishing you happy holidays this year. Get 3 months on us when you purchase or lease a new Volvo.
Now for today's AT&T Inside Access, let's go to the field for some of the halftime festivities. Battle of the Bands, of course, here is as intense as the game, maybe more so. Alabama A&M's marching maroon and white, directed by Carlton White, About to take the field now, Alabama State's mighty marching Hornets, and the Honeybees just wowed the big crowd here, directed by Dr. James B. Oliver. It is a battle of football teams, arch rivals, battle of bands, battle of barbecuers, and everything else here on what's called Magic City Classic Week here in Birmingham, Alabama at Legion Field. Halftime festivities continuing as the maroon and white, the marching band of Alabama A&M, about to take the field and entertain again fans here at Legion Field, trying to decide which band got the better of the activity here at the half. The festivities will continue. We'll be back with more here from Legion Field in Birmingham as halftime action continues here at the Magic City Classic, 14-13, Alabama State.
Most airline credit cards only let you use your miles through their airline.
Well, Capital One doesn't have an airline.
Which means with the Venture Card, you can use your miles for any flight on any airline you want.
It's nice having choices.
Marching band entertaining the thousands here at Legion Field. 60,000 plus expected for the 75th Magic City Classic. As the festivities continue, 14-13 in favor of Alabama State. Jay Walker, Eric Clemens back in the booth with you. And Jay, this was a tale of kind of two halves in the first half. A great start for Alabama State. They get out the quick 14-3 lead. But the momentum now belongs to the Bulldogs of Alabama A&M.
And that's what we said on several occasions. Put them away. When you can grow the lead in a rivalry game, you have to bury them early. Alabama State did not do that. Therefore, Alabama A&M was able to hang around, pick up a little momentum, and steal 3 points at the end of the first half to make this a one-point game.
Alabama State opens the scoring a little bit early on. They get a great punt return from Khalid Thomas.
Yeah, great job by the senior from Tallahassee, Florida, making one cut and getting upfield in a hurry. It really set him up in great field position, and they were able to punch it in on the very next play as Thomas took it in untouched for the first touchdown of the game.
7-0, and then this a big quarterback keeper. Great move there by the quarterback for Alabama State.
QT, when Terrence Cobb is showing he's got athleticism, the ability to finish off the run, longest touchdown run of his career, gave them a lead, and you thought they were going to run away with it. But then here come the Bulldogs. That's what happens in rivalry game. Fantastic catch. Then a little bit of the running game starting to show its head, and the Bulldogs are able to get back in this contest.
And this is Jordan Bentley, the freshman, going up a wide open hole up the middle for the easy touchdown. And they get right back in the ball game at 14-10, and they add a field goal after a late penalty, pushes the ball a bit forward at the end of the second half. Looking at the first half numbers.
Yeah, and Alabama A&M's defense continues to struggle. They're on pace to give up over 500 yards in total offense, but Alabama State not able to capitalize, only has 14 points, and as you saw before, seven of those really came from special teams with a punt return. I expect to see a lot more Jordan Bentley, so I think the rushing yards, if Bentley can continue to run the football, that could be trouble for Alabama State.
All right, Alabama A&M pretty balanced right now as we continue here with the halftime performance of the Mighty Maroon Marching Band of Alabama A&M. We'll get you all set for second half action when we come back here to Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama.
The great thing about an old truck is you can treat it like an old truck, which is exactly why you got a truck in the first place. It's not old, it's broken in. So keep it running longer, stronger, with quality parts and a whole lot of NAPA know-how. That's not gonna buff out.
Around here, the early bird gets the waffle. But for all the other birds who could use a few more minutes of sleep, we've got you covered. Enjoy free breakfast on the run and free Wi-Fi. Book at Hampton.com for a guaranteed discount.
The Alabama A&M marching band still on the field, and of course their message to everybody in attendance, vote B-O-T-E. Finally running off the field. Both teams will get back out there and get ready for what should be an exciting second half of action as 1 point separates Alabama State and Alabama A&M.
It's been 30 minutes since they played football. Both bands went long, yep. But it was a fantastic halftime performance. What'd you think about the Honeybees, Eric? First time seeing
My goodness, I've never seen anything like that either. Those ladies can move, and they brought the house down here at Legion Field. That's wonderful stuff. That is great. I could say more, but I won't.
and you see all the seats are taken, and they've even taken the band seats to watch the performance, so there are more people here than you think, but fantastic event. And what a hard-fought football game. It only helps when you've got a one-point game at halftime along with a 30-minute halftime show. The fans are definitely getting their money's worth today.
And now some fans will make their way back outside to where the party has been going on for at least a couple days. And we'll continue long after this game is over this evening. And needless to say, you and I have been invited to a few stops afterwards around here. And we'll partake in barbecue and everything else.
Southern hospitality.
Southern hospitality.
And they do it in a great way. And, you know, just continue to do it. And this game has grown and grown and continues to grow. And I think the city of Birmingham deserves a lot of credit because they put on a first-class event here. And they've done it for many, many years. What is the longest continuous rivalry game or game play here in the state of Alabama?
Absolutely.
And I thought for sure that would have been Alabama and Auburn, but
yeah,
these two squads.
Kind of surprised me. Anyway, let's take a look at this afternoon's Bringing the Flavor, brought to you by McDonald's. Party time, and the party will continue after we're all said and done here. But we got a tight one, 14-13. Alabama State is we're about to start the second half.
And the Tom Jordan Morning Show was here.
Okay.
And Ricky Smiley was here.
Right.
Everybody was here. More to come. Post game, Ludacris concert. Luda.
Mention kicking that one deep, and Odarius Williams. Williams has a lane. And Williams gets it out across the 40, almost to the 45-yard line. Great return. And we talked about that momentum to end the first half. And Alabama A&M picking up right where it left off with great field position. They'll take over first and 10 at their own 45-yard line after the nice return.
A great return. And the key is put some points on the board. And let's see how Alabama State can play if they're trailing in this football game.
D'Angelo Ballard was 10 of 17, 137 in the first half. He had 9 runs for 77. And his freshman sensation, Jordan Bentley, 7 rushes for 38 yards and a TD in the first half. And before we get anything going, we got a whistle on the field.
This may be a penalty. They warned him in the first half. You know, the rule is when the other team has the ball, your band can't play. So if they try and do is, you know, give them some grace periods, give them a warning. And I think if that happens again, they will be assessed a penalty for band interference. That's one like an HBCU penalty you don't see anywhere else in the country.
Ballard slings it far side. Dangerous pass, but I think it found the hands of his intended receiver, Ladarian Heath, who makes a diving catch, and they'll move the chains first down.
Strong throw by Ballard. Cover two defense, able to squeeze the ball in between the cornerback and the safety. Look at this. You really have to rip this throw all the way across the field. That should be a catch. Nice catch. Good job by Ladarian Heath securing the football.
And Ballard noticeably limping after he threw that pass. Stays on the field, though. We'll see what he looks like here on first and 10. Gives it to Bentley. Bentley shakes off a tackle and gets it inside the 40 to about the 36-yard line as he pushed the pile forward for 6.
And the more I see Jordan Bentley, the more I like that comparison to Matt Forte. I mean, doesn't look flashy. Obviously, he's not the fastest guy on the field, but he's got great vision and balance and can do everything for you, which is why this young kid can be special.
Coach Beatty said they won a recruiting battle for him, and there was some encroachment inside. It looked like going long for it all. It is deflected.
Wow.
And caught in the end zone. Touchdown. Tevin McKenzie, but we'll see what is their flag. Yes, we do have one on the far side of the field. We'll see how they sort that one out, but a deflection and a catch.
It was a great job by D'Angelo Ballard of taking advantage of the free play. He knew that Alabama State was offside and decided to throw the ball up, give it a chance.
Defense, that penalty is declined. The results of the play, touchdown.
And this is how you play the quarterback position. Those are the little intangibles there. You know the defense is offside, so rather than just scramble or take a knee, he said, hey, I'm just going to heave it up there and hope something happens. If it was intercepted, they would have still maintained the football. But a great job by Tevin McKenzie of catching the ricochet for the score.
And the Darian Heath appeared to hit him maybe on his shoulder pad, and Tevin McKenzie, as they say, Johnny on the spot for the deflection and the touchdown. And now suddenly, just like that, Alabama A&M is in front of this ball game by six. It is 20-14. Three-play 57-yard drive takes only 55 seconds. We'll be back.
ESPNU College Football is presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it. And in part by Wall Clippers and Trimmers, Real Guys, Real Grooming. Visit wallrealguys.com.
I'm Keith Hernandez.
And I'm Walt Clyde Frazier.
Hold the show.
That gray beard is a no-go.
In 5 easy minutes, but just for men in it.
Here's the kicker. Your beard will look thicker.
Guys.
At Boar's Head, we don't make jerky. We craft it. Our meat is hand-seasoned and cooked to tender perfection, creating a taste that could only come from Boar's Head. Boar's Head Butchercraft Jerky. Compromise elsewhere.
Thanks to the awareness of Devin McKenzie off the deflection, Alabama A&M's Bulldogs have a 20-16 lead here early in the third quarter. Here at a jam-packed Legion Field, Magic City Classic weekend in Birmingham, Alabama. A&M with 334 total yards, 188 of them passing. State with only 186 total yards. Alan Rios kicking this one deep. And it goes out of bounds on the far side of the field.
And what was Alabama State's lead? Were they up 14-0 at one point? 14-3. They've been stuck on 14, and we start to see him stall.
On the kick and team, the ball will be spotted at the 35-yard line. First down.
One more look at the touchdown, Jim.
Yeah, and good job of just realizing that the defense is offside. That's why I give the credit to Ballard. Say, hey, I've got a free play. He just throws it up for grabs, realizing there's no risk in an interception. And off the ricochet, Tevin McKenzie, the senior from Mobile, Alabama, just made his classic moment. And you see the concentration. That's why you run to the football, to be in the general area of the vicinity. Once the ball is up in the air, great recognition as he runs through the ball to complete the touchdown catch.
Juwan Young Battle beginning the second half here at quarterback. And going around the far side is Daryl King, the 6 foot, 230-pound junior. And he picked up 4 yards on first down off the left side.
And normally when you make a quarterback change, you want to know what the new quarterback is bringing. The completion percentages are about the same. Touchdown interception ratio about the same, but I believe Young Battle's a step or two quicker than Quinteris Toppins, even though Toppins was very effective running the football.
Here's a give on the inside. Handoff that time, and it went to Khalid Thomas, who picked up 4 more. And so it'll be third down and short. Call it third and about 2. As Alabama State needs to try to do something to get momentum back on the offense.
And defensively, I think you force the younger quarterback to throw the football. Load the box, and I would not allow Alabama State to win the number count battle running the ball.
And Khalid Thomas, with that added bulk of 20 pounds this year, pushes the pile forward. They're going to move the chains. It'll be first down, Hornets, as they cross the 45 to just about the 46-yard line. is to lead. Thomas trying to get the corner, and he is brought down. Nice open field tackle on the far side by number 50, Ryan Ducksworth, a 6'1", 244-pound junior, making that play after a four-yard gain.
And I'm a little surprised Alabama A&M's not making an adjustment. Alabama State has gone to keeping a tight end in the ball game to control the numbers. So, you see, this is the tight end right here. So, look at the advantage they have. They've got six, blocking six, advantage offense.
Young Battle throwing it high, and that one is almost intercepted. Is moving over was Dexter Reese from his cornerback spot to knock that one away from the intended target tight end, Brandon Barnes. And that'll set up third down.
And we wanted to see. Very fortunate that ball was not intercepted by Dexter Reese. Crucial third down coming up for the Hornets.
Coach Brian Jenkins has Juwan Young Battle in the empty backfield. Three receivers, puts it in the near side. Goes far side, and that one batted away. Kenneth Davis, the Mike backer, moves all the way over and knocks that one away in the flat, and a big stop that time again by Alabama A&M.
This is how you play inside linebacker. In a passing situation, he's going to look up the most dangerous man to the outside divider of the field, and he locates him, and you'll see Davis right here. He realizes, I'm going to need to give help over here, and look at his approach. And when this ball's thrown, he has a beat on it all the way. Slides over, makes the break, finds the football. That's how you play pass coverage.
And we have a whistle before the punt. And we'll see how they sort things out here on the field. And I believe they are ruling that his knee hit the ground as he fielded the snap for the punt. And that means the ball is downed right there. What a break for Alabama A&M as they'll get the ball in great field position. Remember in college,
yep,
body part touches the ground, you are ruled down by contact and turnover on downs. Wow.
All right, and that's a huge change of field position because it was a really good punt.
So first and 10 with the ball at the 36-yard line. And Ballard trying to strike quickly. Going for it all. Has a man open. Overshot him on the far side of the field as he looked for Ladarian Heath. Oh.
You have to hit that pass. He's ahead of the guy by 3.5 yards. Why even risk overthrowing that ball? I mean, you can miss by 2 yards and still have a touchdown. That's tough. They dial it up. I mean, it doesn't get any more wide open. On a go route, look, that cornerback is like, I'm beat. And threw it out of bounds and long. It just frustrates me because we've seen him make great passes. Just have to become more consistent as a passer.
What amazes me is how the momentum of this game is turned on a dime. It looked like Alabama State might be off to an easy win. And this is Bentley inside. And Bentley showing that style that we've been talking about all game. He kind of just looked like he was waiting for something to happen there. And when it did, he exploded into the secondary.
He's not flashy, but he has great vision. And you have to have great vision to be a runner. And you don't see him getting hit. His running style's a little bit high. You think somebody's really going to hit him hard, but he sees all the would-be tacklers coming, and he's able to make them miss.
23 yards that time for number 23, the true freshman. The leading rusher among freshmen in the SWAC. And there's a quick pass on the near side to Tevin McKenzie. Hero on the last drive with the deflected touchdown catch. And he gets that ball down inside the 10 to the 7-yard line.
Alabama A&M able to pick up a first down still. They can pick up 3 or 4 more yards. Great opportunity to allow Jordan Bentley to run and at least pick up the first down, maybe even a touchdown.
The Bulldogs came into the game ranking 15th in all of FCS in red zone scoring. 19 of 21, and on the keeper,
nice
in around
call.
The corner. That was Ballard. Did he get in? They rule it a touchdown. D'Angelo Ballard gets inside the pylon, and now Alabama A&M trying to increase that lead to at least 13 with the extra point.
Nice call. By design, and really good job by Jordan Bentley, the freshman. Look at number 23. Get up there and become the lead blocker. Get in the way of two would-be tacklers a good job of extending the football, and all you're going to do is hit the pylon with the nose of the ball. If you're D'Angelo Ballard, hesitate and watch him extend. Knees not down, foot's in play. That's touchdown, Bulldogs. Did you see this coming?
Absolutely not, especially the way the game started with Alabama State striking quickly. A couple of big plays in the special teams game and the big long run by Quinteris Toppings and giving them 14-3 lead, and then all of a sudden, bam.
And that's the key, you know, put them on the ropes and see how they react. So give credit to Alabama A&M. They took the best shot of Alabama State. Now they're doing a counterpunch, and Alabama State has to show that they can take Alabama A&M's punch.
The only question might have been if the left foot don't touched out of bounds. The only question they could have. He
don't
obviously hit the pylon on the inside with the ball. The only question they could possibly be looking at is if the left foot touched out of bounds before he started his dive.
Yeah, I looked at that a couple of replays. So I thought I saw enough green in there. And I definitely didn't see enough to say he was clearly out of bounds.
Right.
But you have to be.
Right.
You have to be
clear.
100% certain.
So up here in the booth, we have a consensus. We think it's a touchdown. Okay.
And that being said, you know they're probably going to call him out for one. the way my batting average has been going this year.
I think mine's a little worse than yours, so. And Coach Spady going, what are we looking at? What are we taking so long for? Touchdown, easy. Let's go.
This has to worry if you're
Alabama. You need to keep
A&M.
This momentum.
Because when it takes this long, it only means you're looking to overturn something.
Yeah.
But I thought it was pretty clear. Can't be 100% certain he's out of bounds unless there's an angle we don't have.
Coach Brian Jenkins patiently waiting on the decision.
There's our average.
Well, as I said, the only thing they could be reviewing was whether he stepped out of bounds as he began the dive toward the pylon, and they ruled that he apparently did. They're going to place the ball at the 1 yard line, and it'll be first and goal with 10:26 to go here in the third quarter.
Hold on to the football. So often we've seen a team fumble the ball after this call.
And here's Bentley. And Bentley didn't get anything. He got back to the original line of scrimmage inside the one. That'll be second and goal.
Well, let's take a look at what they called back. And they said the left foot was out of bounds. I thought this was close. As we get closer to the sideline, it'd be nice to slow it down and see.
If the left foot was out, it's out right there, and that's about the 2.5 to 3 yard line. They spotted the ball at the one.
And I can say, are you 100% certain he wasn't in play?
And now that one is a touchdown as the late ruling comes in from the far side of the field. And that is Jordan Bentley scoring his second touchdown of the game. And now, barring review,
they're reviewing it. I can see the replay officials coming out. They're going to take a look at this.
I mean, he went in amongst a mass of bodies. I don't know how you could possibly see that he didn't cross the plane to the goal line.
And that's what I say. If you have officials on the field, go with the call unless you can be certain that the guy didn't get into the end zone. They obviously saw something on the field to make him signal touchdown. When you start to say, well, I'm not sure if he got in, and
now this play under official review.
The play of a touchdown is under further review.
So let's see if there's going to be something to overturn this. I mean, moving forward, it's momentum. momentum. He reaches out there. Good play. It's a good play, but that's that vision we talk about, which we've seen Jordan Bentley display. They do a good job. Barry wraps up his arms, but he extends the football while going to the ground. This is the touchdown there. I'm afraid to say it's a touchdown.
Now I'm gonna tick you off a little bit again.
The only thing
they could review is if his body went down before he extends the ball across the goal line.
No.
Just like last time.
After further review,
down, he extended the ball.
And touchdown.
You like messing with me.
So we just did a fist bump up here. I was messing with you a little bit. I mean, it certainly looked, well, the last play certainly looked like a touchdown, too.
Yeah, well, at least we're back to 500 today. See if we can keep it there.
No longer below the Mendoza line there. Six plays, 36 yards, 2 minutes and 9 seconds, and Coach James Spady's team has wrested all the momentum away, trying to add now to a 12-point lead and make it 13 on the extra point of Nick Carden, which is right through the uprights. A&M has scored now 24 unanswered points. And the Bulldogs lead it 27-14, 9:36 to go here in the third quarter.
ESPNU College Football is brought to you by Devour, new in the freezer section. It's food you want to fork.
Attention, Holiday Inn Express guests! Everyone, go back to bed! Repeat, everyone, back to bed! My new snoozer-palooza's in full effect. That means late breakfast. Check out till noon! So sleep in, baby! Snoozer-palooza's gonna be great.
Definitely.
What?
Definitely!
High fives all around!
Yeah!
You're eating, okay.
Late breakfast and check out till noon. Just what your weekend needs.
We're gonna prove just how wet and sticky your current gel antiperspirant is. And now we're gonna show you how Degree Dry Spray is different. Degree Dry Spray goes on instantly dry for a cleaner feel. Degree, it won't let you down.
Legion Field, Birmingham, Alabama. If you're a member of the Alabama A&M marching band, you are pretty happy right now and saying, get away from me, you little Hornets. We have the momentum in this game, 27-14 in favor of the Bulldogs here in the third quarter, where the party has been going on since early this week out at Legion Field. The campers, hundreds of thousands of people descending here on Birmingham, Alabama for Classic Week, Classic Weekend.
It's interesting because before the game, Coach Spady said, Jay, you don't think we can win this football game, do you? And I said, I want a competitive game. I'm neutral. And he said, he just had that little wink in his eye like, we think we can do this. And I'll tell you what, when they went down 14-3, I thought false confidence. But now, up by 13 here in the second half, plenty of football still left to be played. But right now is the time for Alabama State to test their mettle.
Markwell Beckwith with a nice return out to the 46-yard line. And Brian Jenkins' offense has to do something and do something in a hurry as momentum has swung totally to the side of Alabama A&M in this battle. Quinteris Toppings back in at quarterback, number 12. And he will hand it to Khalid Thomas. And Thomas gets it close to midfield off the right side, picked up three.
And you can take Alabama State out of their comfort zone right now. When they're in the trail position, we talked about what they like to do. Their philosophy, control the line of scrimmage, run the football. Down by 13, every time you run the football and get tackled inbounds, you're losing 25, 30 seconds off that play clock. So I think they're going to have to leave their comfort zone and start throwing the football at an increased capacity.
Off the play fake, Toppings looking deep downfield, trying to go between two defenders. And there is no flag. As he was looking for his freshman receiver, Palmer Graham, deep down the field, but he threw it into double coverage.
Yeah, but this is pass interference. The safety didn't even see where the football was, and he grabbed the wide receiver. And that's one where you throw the ball deep there, and it just looked like Jerry Callaway was in no man's land.
Until this will set up third down. Third and long for Quinteris Toppings. And the offense, Khalid Thomas, is set back to his right. Three receivers split out to the far side top of your screen. And now we have a stoppage on the field.
While we got a chance and a stop on the field, let's take a look at that last play where I thought it should have been pass interference when I first saw it. Look at the safety in the middle of your screen. You see him here. Watch his pursuit to the ball. He loses where the football's going. You'll see him come back into the screen. And when he comes back in, he doesn't even see the football. He just grabs the wide receiver. Stops him from making the catch.
Teray Callaway was the would-be culprit on that play.
But it goes back to this. How do you not call that? Did you see that pass interference?
He guys, certainly not looked like he grabbed
football.
Him to me.
He grabbed the receiver, stopped him from going to the football. Instead, it's another tough break for Alabama State.
Big third down play for Alabama State. Toppings fires and his receiver had fallen down. He was looking for Loia McCary. And he just went down, but evidently not caused by some contact from the defenders. And so once again, Alabama State kind of stuck in neutral on offense after a couple of positive plays, and they're going to have to punt it away.
They're leaving their comfort zone. When you make a team uncomfortable with their philosophy, if their team that likes to pass a lot, and then you take away the pass and only give them the run, they get frustrated. Well, Alabama A&M is taking away the rushing game. And by having the lead, forcing Alabama State to throw the ball more than they like.
Trevor Vincent, the low line drive to Rashad Anderson, who fair catches it at his 15. And once again, Alabama A&M will take over. And what they're looking to do is kind of adopt the philosophy of Alabama State. Grind the ball out on the ground a little bit, run some clock, and hold on to this two-score lead, two touchdowns anyway.
And they cannot get complacent, which is the key. Stay aggressive, do what you've done, which has been running the football with Jordan Bentley and some timely catches. Last drive for Alabama A&M. It all started right here off the punt. Punter goes down, knees on the ground. They get the ball on the 35-yard line. And good job of going, throwing the ball downfield. Missed opportunity on the catch, but they got a couple good runs from Jordan Bentley, and that's how they were able to increase their lead.
And going down on his own off the scramble, D'Angelo Ballard, and he picked up seven on that first down play. So on second and short, of course, the last two possessions have ended with a 37-yard reception off the deflection by McKenzie. And here's a nice run this time by backup running back Harvey Harris up the middle. Of course, Bentley capped the last march on a 1-yard touchdown run, stretching it across the goal line. And Alabama A&M with all the momentum right now, inside of 8 minutes to go here in the third quarter.
And this is gut check time right now for the Alabama State season. You know, defense has to make some plays. They have to get it together or else they're just playing out the rest of the schedule.
And Harris trying to cut back to the other side of the field, and he is brought down and brought down hard by Ricky Haley. Backup defensive end, the 6'3", 245-pound sophomore out of Norfolk, Virginia.
And that was a play that they have to make. Something just to change the momentum. The longer this game just kind of drags out, the less likelihood it seems that Alabama State's going to emerge victorious.
Ballard throwing far side. That's off the hands of his intended receiver, Tevin McKenzie. McKenzie, their dynamic playmaker out of the slot, has already made his presence felt in the game. Came in with 32 catches for 346 yards. And so now it'll be third and 11. Big play this time for the Alabama State defense. Got to get a hold here and get the ball back. Try to get back into this one and make it a one-score game. Ballard with the empty backfield. Going deep. And overshot his intended receiver. He was looking that time for Marcellus Clash. Or Odarius Williams also out there on the far side. Looking for the deep ball and incomplete, so they'll have to punt it away with Nick Carden punting deep to the dangerous Khalid Thomas. And ever since that big punt return early, they've been kicking them low and kind of away from number seven. I can't say I blame them.
Yeah, smart move. Angled directional punt if you could.
And just as I say that, he kicks it away high, but it's a dead bounce. Bounces right to the side where it's down at the 45-yard line of Alabama State, but that is excellent field position for the Hornets. And Coach Jenkins trying to rally his troops and get their offense to get something going here. In the first quarter, State with 14 points and 86 yards. Since then, they've run 30 plays for only 104 yards with no points.
And that's about a three yard per play average, a little bit less than 3 yards per play, and that's why they find themselves in the position that they are, in the trail position. And it'd be different if, you know, they knew they could run the ball well, but we don't necessarily know what they can do. They haven't shown the ability to dominate the line of scrimmage for the running game, and they haven't had the breakout play in the passing game.
And the give goes inside, bouncing off tacklers. A good yardage is Khalid Thomas. Thomas picked up 9, just short of first down yardage. It'll be second and short now. They appear to be picking up the tempo just a little bit.
Did you see the shiftiness on display by Khalid Thomas on that run there? Look at this. Changes directions quickly, makes him miss in a hurry, and that's the great vision from a running back that you need. Next play, he picks up 9, then he's able to pick up the first down again as it's first and 10. Khalid Thomas showing you why he's one of the best runners in the SWAC.
6.6 yard per carry average coming into this game for 2016. Second in the SWAC in rushing. And here's Toppings looking deep. Has a man, and he's got it. End zone, touchdown. Willis White. Yards for the 6 foot 181 pound junior out of Hollywood, Florida, and it couldn't come at a more desperate time if you're Alabama State.
Yeah, they needed that one there. Good job by White of making the catch, but the protection by the offensive line was phenomenal, giving Toppins more than enough time to complete the strike down the field.
3 plays, 55 yards, and the scoring strike wakes up the Alabama State offense, and now we await the extra point of David Albert. And that one's right through. So now we're back to a one-score game, 27-21 in favor of Alabama A&M. One more look at the touchdown. And Alabama State strikes quickly to Willis White to get back in.
Wherever is your heart, I call
Ethan. Alex. Nice to meet you, Alex. Would you like to dance?
Sure.
Friday night at 7?
Yeah.
What do you want to play?
It's super cool.
Alabama A&M cut to 6 thanks to the touchdown catch of Willis White in the end zone, waking up the Alabama State offense back deep to receive this kickoff. Odarius Williams and Harvey Harris for Alabama A&M. A&M, by the way, 22nd touchdown pass allowed this season. That's the third most in FCS behind Yale and Stephen F. Austin, who both allowed 26 TD passes so far this year. And that's a short pooch kind of kickoff, and it's fielded on the near side And they wave it dead at the 31-yard line.
And now it goes back to Alabama A&M. I still think you need to extend the lead. And, you know, everybody's always trying to score, but at a certain point, Alabama A&M, that 13-point lead disappeared quickly. Now you're up by six. You're going to have to pick up a couple first downs. Either way, a little bit of clock as well as maybe establish you can run the football behind Jordan Bentley.
Roderick Randolph fielded that kickoff at his 29. Backup tight end. D'Angelo Ballard setting up the screen near side, and off balance was his intended receiver, Jordan Bentley. So that one goes incomplete. Bentley trying to get out of the way of some linemen there to make the catch and turn it upfield, but never really regained his balance. So it'll be second down and 10. Second down, here's Ballard on the keeper, trying to turn the corner, is not allowed to. He's forced out of bounds right about the original line of scrimmage for little or no gain. And Ishmael Arisman was the man who made the tackle, the defensive end.
Now we're looking at third and long, obvious passing situation, and this is where you need your senior quarterback to make a play for you. Either through the air or with his feet, running the ball if the defense gives it to him.
Here's Ballard on the quarterback keeper, and he has tackled. Very nice play in the open field to keep him from getting big yardage because there was nobody else in front there. Brought down at the 31-yard line. So once again, Alabama A&M forced to punt, and Alabama State will get the ball back in fairly decent shape.
They're confusing him. They're bringing Barry and the linebacker on one side, but they're still having gap control. Well, because Barry leaves the middle of the field, Ballard thinks it's wide open. Well, that's three consecutive times they brought that blitz and passing situation, and I just think it's confusing D'Angelo Ballard. He's thinking there's running lane there when it's really not.
Khalid Thomas back deep, and this is a line drive kick. Thomas will field it at his 30. Khalid Thomas with a lane cross midfield. Now he's got one man to beat and a blocker in front. He's caught from behind inside the 10 to the 7-yard line. Khalid Thomas making his presence felt on special teams once again.
Great job, but yeah, this should have been a touchdown run. He had a blocker out in front. Got a call like I see it. Kadeem Thomas, number 45, is going to look back at Khalid Thomas in front, and instead of blocking somebody, he's looking. Look, you're right there. You're the lead guy. You're the entourage. Hit the kicker, man. Come on. That's the difference between a touchdown and having to settle for a field goal with a stop. And now this really isn't good because Khalid Thomas is laying down on the sideline.
One of the tacklers on that play, the punter, Nick Carton himself.
How do you not block anybody? It's punt return. And you've got a kicker there. I mean, football players love hitting kickers because they don't wear a lot of padding. I mean, I thought he should have cleaned his clock.
39-yard punt, a 61-yard return for Khalid Thomas.
Let's see. Yeah, the kicker's right foot, right leg is involved in that. And he takes a knee to the back of the helmet. Oh.
So a couple of players banged up on that bang bang return of 61 yards by Khalid Thomas. And just like that, thanks to special teams, here's Alabama State with a chance to tie with a touchdown and go ahead with a touchdown and extra point. Quinn Terrace Toppings back in there at quarterback on first and 10. and toppings. Design quarterback keeper play. Turns the far corner and gets it inside the five. It'll be marked out of bounds at about the 4-yard line after a pickup of 5 yards on the play. Khalid Thomas with 3 punt returns, 115 yards so far in this game. And it's just when we talked about keeping it away from him, he kicked the last two his way, and they dearly paid for that one. Inside, that is Beckwith, and Beckwith plows in for the touchdown. Markwell Beckwith, the graduate student from Montgomery, Alabama, has tied this game with a short touchdown run.
Great job by Beckwith of keeping his balance after the initial contact, able to spin away from the tackler, stay on his feet, and into the end zone for a touchdown. Take a look. You're going to see a nice collision in the middle of that pile. Runs into, actually, it's his own offensive lineman, Sam Baptiste, number 74. He can go down with the contact and able to get to the end zone. And now Alabama State with an opportunity to take the lead in this football game. And they were just down by 13.
Took them only 30 seconds after the big punt return of 61 yards by Khalid Thomas and 9 yards in 2 plays to get the game tying score. And now
false start, snap infraction, number 54, offense, 5-yard penalty, still the point after 10.
Dylan Reniker moving the football around a little bit, can't do that, so David Albert will have to attempt this one from about 25 yards out. And that's a low line drive. It appeared maybe that somebody got a little piece of it, but it's still enough to get through from 25 on the extra point. And now Alabama State has taken the lead 28-27. We got a whale of a game here, and couldn't ask for anything more here at Legion Field in Birmingham. And we are welcoming in now the mayor of the great city of Birmingham, Alabama. Mayor William Bell joins us here in the booth right now. And Mayor, welcome. The city has been quite a gracious host to us all week long, a classic week. Your assessment of everything going on here?
Well, listen, we spend all of our time putting the red carpet in the cleaners to make sure that when we roll it out, it's rolled out properly. And I want to thank everybody for really making this special, the 75th anniversary of this great game between these two schools. And you couldn't ask for a better game. I mean, it goes, the ebb and flow goes back and forth. Listen, I'm so used to you having a barbecue bone in your hand. I don't know. I'm not used to you seeing with an empty hand.
When he introduced you, he said, Mayor Bell, I was like, my man. That's my man first and foremost. And always you show us a great time. Mr. Mayor, his first classic. So he's overwhelmed by it all. So I think you have a new fan.
I can barely speak. So this is incredible.
So next time you send me over a little rib kit, send it over for two.
We'll do. But really, we appreciate everything that ESPN does to make this an outstanding game and to let the world know what kind of talent we have on both of these schools. Regardless of what the record is, when they get on that field, it's anybody's game.
Yeah, so let me put you on the spot here.
Yeah.
So who's going to win? Alabama State, Alabama A&M?
The team with the most scores.
Who are you pulling for, Alabama State, Alabama
A&M? The team with the most scores. I'm a politician.
Speaking politically and economically, what does an event like this, 60,000 people plus inside, 100,000 people plus outside, RVs, tents, what does it do for the local economy here in the city of Birmingham?
Our Chamber of Commerce estimate that it's probably a $20 million economic impact that it has on the city. But more importantly, it gives us a chance to support both schools with the cash contributions that we make, because at the end of the day, while we enjoy the game, it's about academics, and that's what this is all about. So
we mentioned earlier, we're driving through downtown Birmingham, a lot of new construction, new cranes.
Yes.
I know that's always a good sign, and obviously the city of Birmingham is well steeped in tradition in terms of civil rights. It seems like Birmingham is healing and now starting to prosper.
Well, you know, for so long, for 50 years, we ran away from the history of the city. We tried to say, oh, let sleeping dogs lie. But when we came into office, we said we're going to embrace our past so that we can have a clear view of our future, to let the world know who Birmingham is, and that we can come together and have a decent family event like this game, and you know, do a lot of good things in the community to turn things around, and we're on the move.
I also had an opportunity to visit the new baseball stadium. Nice.
Oh, yes.
Birmingham
Barons
steep in tradition down here.
Absolutely.
Fantastic facilities you all have there.
You know, baseball was on the decline for a long time, but now it's on the rise in the community. We got kids playing Little League baseball, and there's no telling what kind of talent is going to come out. I was watching the World Series. Look at him, Scamper.
Better get rid of it.
Yeah, I'm telling you.
Oh, and he had a man wide open. Ladarian Heath was in the middle of the field. Nobody within 10 yards of him. That's a tough throw.
That's a tough throw, but it's not a hard throw. Once you get away from everybody, that's the hard part. It was a wide open receiver. Kind of remind me of Fran.
Spoken like a former star quarterback.
It remind me of Fran Tarkenton a little bit. We've got an official down on the field.
Let's hope this isn't serious.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're looking at the play, so I did not see him go down behind the play, evidently. After Ballard turned the corner and got away from the rush there.
And when we've got football players changing directions, changing the whole flow of the play, sometimes the officials might have just got caught in a bad position.
We won't even begin to speculate what might have happened there. I know there are a lot of bodies chasing the quarterback onto the near side of the field, but no idea, might have been a misstep and a hurt knee, and then we have a player down as well on the field, and he's being helped up and taken off at the 40-yard line on the far side, favoring the left leg, and that was Robert Easterwood, a backup safety, a sophomore out of Fayetteville, Georgia, but more importantly, the official still down, being attended to by the medical staff here. And again, we certainly hope this isn't something serious. But Mayor, you know, you've handled this so well for so many years. These many thousands of people coming into Birmingham. Southern Hospitality is alive and well. I haven't seen any beefs outside or anybody. Everybody's having a wonderful time, and the city of Birmingham has just been such a gracious
host. Listen, the weather has been just absolutely beautiful, and I want to thank everyone who has come together to make this a great day and a great event for the city of Birmingham and both schools.
So let's take a look.
I thank you guys for bringing your talent to Birmingham.
Does he get hit?
Thank you.
That might be just a ham.
Looked like he tripped over himself there as Ballard went past him, escaping the rush. Mayor William Bell,
thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us up here in the booth. Thank you so much for hosting us here for the 75th Classic. And whether I'm broadcasting or not, I think I'll make it back for number 76.
There you go. Appreciate it. And
yeah,
listen,
thank you.
I'm going to have to find you a barbecue bone.
We will. You always take care. We take care.
Thank you, man.
Khalid Thomas with the fair catch inside his 25. It'll be marked at the 24-yard line, where Alabama State will take over with a one-point lead. Seemed like Jay Walker 2 seconds ago, they were trailing by 13 and now up by one with a chance to try to establish that ground attack again and eat some time off the clock and put this one away if they can.
And it was a good job because you realize, you know, we said it, their season was on the line. I think if Alabama A&M would have put some more points on during that drive when they had the football to increase the lead from 13 to 20 or even 16, then I thought they might have just gone away. Instead, Coach Brian Jenkins has to be proud of the way that his football squad fought to stay in the game, had a couple big plays, one with the pass to the end zone from Toppins to Willis White, and then another fantastic punt return by Khalid Thomas, and now they're in the lead.
Last two drives have taken 5 plays, 64 yards, and only a buck 14. But have produced a couple touchdowns. Here's the handoff to the lead running back. And this time it's Markwell Beckwith, the graduate student from Montgomery. And he blasts across the right side for 10 plus yards and make it 15. And they'll move the sticks. First down, ball spotted at the 38-yard line. Khalid Thomas a little banged up on that long punt return that set up the last touchdown for Alabama State. Another inside handoff, shaking off tackles that time. And picking up 2 more yards is Markwell Beckwith.
And Beckwith, he's going to be a good one. Well, he is a good one, I should say. But spells Khalid Thomas, and you can tell they can run the football there.
Coach Jenkins told us earlier this year that Beckwith could easily be a starter for him or in any other program, so he doesn't have any qualms at all about putting number 28, his graduate student, running back in the game, and they can still control the ball on the ground. And that looks like number 7 is back in the game, healthy and well, Khalid Thomas, blasting it off the left side. And he picks up 5 on that first down run play. Boy, he's brought down Kenneth Davis, the Mike linebacker coming off the field for A&M, their leading tackler on defense, one of the leading tacklers in the conference. And now we have a whistle and a stoppage on the field as they sort things out, I believe, maybe
please
with this.
Reset the play clock to 40 seconds. Thank you.
Quinteris Topping is going to deal with a fresh play clock as it was reset to 40 seconds, and now we're ready to go on 3rd and 3. And Thomas showing some great moves, bursting into the secondary to the far side. He's got one man to beat. And he has finally wrestled out of bounds just outside the 10-yard line. What a move to bounce it outside by Khalid Thomas.
And it started from the very beginning of the play, making the initial man miss behind the line of scrimmage. Fantastic jump stop. You're going to see Khalid Thomas go one way with the ball. Watch the jump stop to bounce outside, then see a crease, accelerate. One more shake to buy some more distance and space. And it became a foot race before he was knocked out of bounds at the 11-yard line.
Give him 43 yards on that play, and this is Marquell Beckwith getting it just about to the 10-yard line before he is stacked up. And we do have a penalty marker on the play. Kenneth Davis was one of those who stacked him up at the point of attack. And we'll see how they sort it out. Of course, Coach Jenkins doesn't smile a whole lot, so you can't tell by looking at his expression what may have happened.
There are 2 fouls on the play. Personal foul, illegal hands to the face. Number 1, offense. Personal foul, illegal hands to the face. Number 12, defense. Those penalties offset. Replay, first down.
Josh Davis, the wide receiver for Alabama State, a junior out of Tallahassee, and Devontae Simon, a junior out of Reform, Alabama, giving each other the business, as one of those NFL officials used to say, going head-to-head, and both called for personal foul penalties, which offset. Alex Anderson now on in the backfield, number 5, behind Quinteris Toppings as they get the play call on 1st and 10. They can get first down yardage just outside the 1-yard line. And bursting through a big hole on the left side is Alex Anderson, and he goes in for the touchdown, and suddenly the Hornets of Alabama State have wrested control in this one.
Found a couple creases, and the offensive line showed up, figured out a way to run the football effectively. It's been running back by committee. Lee Thomas, Alex Anderson, and Marquell Beckwith. You see Alex Anderson just gets a full head of steam going. And look at that. That's just poor defensive assignment football by Alabama A&M's defense.
5 plays, 76 yards, completed with the extra point. Still a 1-score game, however, as Alabama State leads it 35-27. Again, a 5-play, 76-yard drive took up 2 minutes and 38 seconds. And we are down to 11 ticks to go here in the third quarter of what has been a good battle here in the 75th edition of the Magic City Classic.
And that last play here, you talk about gap control football, right? So when you talk about football, everybody's responsible for a gap. These are the different gaps, right? So if you got gap control, you get bodies in here to assign each of the gaps. There's no place to run, right? Watch the poor gap control by these two defenders right here. Which gap are they going to? They left a gap open in the middle, down the C gap for a touchdown. So when they over pursue and you start looking for the football instead of maintaining your responsibility in your gap, bad things happen. And that was a good job of recognizing by Alex Anderson.
That was a good bit of teaching, a little football 101 from
I know a little bit.
Of the academic institution.
That is Howard University.
That is Howard University. I got to remember to add that part next time.
Yes.
35-27, 11 seconds to go here in the third quarter. And another little pooch kick coming down on the near side. And A&M will return this one to about the 35-yard line before it is brought down. Kalias Robertson was the one who caught the short kick off one of the up men. He's a backup tight end. And he got that one out across the 35-yard line. So we'll have time for maybe one more play here in the third quarter.
And I want to say it was a great third quarter for Alabama A&M, but it became a great third quarter for Alabama State.
And just, you know, proves the point that you made earlier and that the mayor, William Bell, made himself. Despite the records, it doesn't matter what they are, throw it away when you get a rivalry game like this on a big stage like this, one of the biggest in all of college football.
It's a lot of offense. What is that? The halftime score was 14-13, so Alabama State has added 21 points in the third quarter at Alabama A&M. Normally, you add 14 points, you should be winning the football game in a one-point game, but instead, find themselves trailing.
D'Angelo Ballard off the play fake, going to keep it to the far side. And he's finally run down and pushed out of bounds, and that should do it for the third quarter. That is the final play of the third quarter here. It has come to an end, and Alabama State leading by a score and a two-point conversion. It's 35-27. The 75th edition of the Magic City Classic will continue. Fourth quarter play here from Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama, in just a few moments.
Join the sausage party this election day. Vote for Frank.
You need to give them hope.
Frank on immigration.
Once you go taco, you never go backo.
Join the sausage party.
We have forks. Kind of like Chinese food restaurants have forks. You could use them, but people will see. Besides, you have two perfectly good utensils at the ends of your arms. Ones that are evolutionarily tuned to handle nachos and wings. And if you ever do find yourself in some sort of salad situation, we've got chips.
Dusk falling here in the city of Birmingham, Alabama, Legion Field, and we have had momentum shifts at least on three separate occasions in this one. Alabama State had it first, then Alabama A&M got it back. Now Alabama State has it back as we start the first quarter. A&M on second down and the completion to the far side of the field as Ballard finds his receiver Tevin McKenzie. And McKenzie has been busy all afternoon.
And that's that throw that they've got, just running him into the flat. And Alabama State seems okay giving up the underneath stuff. Doing a good job of making solid tackles in the open field.
Nice solid throw, a lot of heat on that throw across the field for D'Angelo Ballard. Picking up first down yardage to his leading receiver. McKenzie caught his first touchdown pass of the year earlier today. And now a wide receiver reverse throwing back the other way, and that one almost intercepted, but caught on the deflection as they threw back to the cornerback on the reverse. And almost picking that one off was Trayon Garnett. But it wound up into the hands of D'Angelo Ballard, who'll get credit for a reception and a 7-yard gain.
He sees it, you know, that pretty obvious that they're going to do the throwback, and makes a nice break on the ball and tries to go up and bat the ball down. I really thought he should have gone for the interception with two hands. Would have been a great play. You know, DBs play DB for defensive back for a reason. The wide receivers that can't catch. Yeah.
Brian Brower that time on the carry. Off the left side and gets very close to first down yardage. He picked up two. It'll be third down and a long one. And a big third down play for Alabama A&M, down by a score, trailing 35-27.
This is two down territory if you don't lose any yardage on this play.
And just as you say that, it looks like they do lose yardage, but getting a big push from behind his offensive lineman is Brian Brower. And I believe Brower will be marked down still about a yard, maybe a little less, short of the first down.
It's classic. You go for it. They were able to get close enough to the line of scrimmage. Ball's across midfield. You challenge your team and say, we need to get half a yard to stay in this football game.
Big fourth down play, fourth and one. And a big hole off the far side and first down yardage and then some. Goes Brian Brower. He picks up five and they'll move the chains. Alabama State had converted 6 of 12 on fourth downs this season. Alabama A&M rather.
Touchdown saving tackle by Courtney Berry. Brower had a full head of steam going and almost ran through that tackle.
See a lot of those short yardage plays where the defense pinches inside and the runner bounces outside, nobody's there. Speaking of bouncing outside, coming to the near side this time was Brower. Picking up good yardage on first down that time. Give him six before Courtney Berry brought him down.
Berry had to chase him down. You know, Courtney Berry, we talked about the numbers being down. He's been dealing with injuries and playing with a big knee brace during his senior year for such a decorated player. And you can tell he's just a step slower. Just a step slower and not able to get to the point of impact as soon as he would like while his knee continues to recover. But there was no way he wasn't going to play in the Classic.
Jordan Bentley got a breather. Now he takes it off the thigh. And boy, is he brought down hard, flipping in the air. That time, making the tackle, coming up from the secondary, number 43. And putting him down.
Yeah, but when I say airborne. It was a nice hit, but it's first down, Alabama A&M.
Joshua Hill.
Well, that's the thing. You got the big hit, but you were a yard short. And Jordan Bentley able to come away with the first down.
Joshua Hill, true freshman, making that tackle. But again, first down yardage. And here's Ballard escaping some pressure. And he'll take it as far as he can on the far side. Actually picked up close to 6 yards on that scramble for his life. So when you got the dual threat quarterbacks, it can be so frustrating. You got good coverage, you got a good rush, but he still gets out of contain and picks up 6 yards on first down for you.
And one thing about D'Angelo Ballard, he's going to leave the pocket too soon rather than too late. Some guys, you have to force him out. Ballard drops back saying, okay, if I see anything I don't like, I'm taking off. So he escapes quickly, kind of takes him away from his progressions, but when he makes good runs like that, you don't complain.
Brian Brower back in the game at the halfback spot. And he picks up 2 that time off the right side. So you have to wonder if Jordan Bentley might be a little bit nicked up. The freshman sensation came in here with 8 touchdowns, 2nd in the conference, 3rd in the conference in rushing yards, a true freshman. And the last couple series, he's been on the field for 1 play. It's the 11th play of this march. And here's Brower again. Brower pulling his way inside the 20 to the 18-yard line. They'll move the chains once again. First down yardage. And Alabama A&M methodically moving the ball down the field. Courtney Berry, the middle linebacker, in there to make the stop on that one, but not until he had first down yardage.
Well, a good job of running the football on this drive, whether it's been by the quarterback or by Brian Brower, bringing in the power running game. Now the substitution come in, they're going to have to wait a couple seconds to give Alabama State an opportunity to adjust.
And Darius Williams ran in off the field, and here's a quick strike down the near side. And boy, wide open was Marcellus Clash, and he was just overshot in the end zone. Streak down the near sideline appeared to be pretty free.
I mean, it's a couple times we've seen Aaron throws to the end zone, and that's what you have to wonder. If you're Alabama A&M, an offense that averages 25 points a game, if you make those other throws, just accurate throws, then you could be in the 40s. They've had opportunities, just Aaron throws.
Second down, coming in for the reverse. This time it looks like Tevin McKenzie, and McKenzie gets it inside the 15 to the 14-yard line. He picked up 5 on that inside reverse from his wide receiver spot. McKenzie has run the ball quite a bit this year. He's run the ball 14 times for 100 yards coming into the game. And we have an injured player down on the field. Looks like Ishmael Arisman, the 6'3", 240-pound junior out of Miami, Florida, and also Alabama State's best pass rusher off the edge. And we're going to take a timeout on the field here, and they'll attend to Arisman. And we'll continue with fourth quarter action in just a moment here in the 75th Magic City Classic.
ESPNU College Football is presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it.
Once you get in the Army, you hear the term Ranger and you look at it as the highest standards. I was extremely proud to be part of the 1st Ranger Battalion. When I was deployed, I knew that USAA was taking care of my wife when she was back home. And now I know with my son that the USAA will continue to provide the insurance and protection we need.
They always say, you've served your country, so we're here to serve you.
My name is Alejandro Villanueva, and I'm a USAA member for life.
Call USAA today to talk about your insurance needs.
ESPN College Football presented by McDonald's. It is the 75th Magic City Classic, and we have had quite a ball game here at Legion Field in Birmingham. Alabama State has come from behind and leads it by a score of 35-27 over A&M. Big third down, quarterback draw, and D'Angelo Ballard on the 14th play of the drive is going to be a little short of the first down. All right, Coach, is this four down territory? Do you go for it here, or do you take the three?
Take the three.
And they do have Nick Carden, one of the better kickers.
Because you're down by eight, and you're going to need to score a touchdown and a two-point conversion. If you take the 3 points now and then you score, then you take the lead.
Doesn't look like they're listening to us in any way, shape, or form. They're going to go for it on fourth, and it's a long two. And we were questioning about Jordan Bentley. He is back in the game behind D'Angelo Ballard, and now we got a timeout on the field taken by Alabama State.
I mean, let's talk this out. You got, you know, 8 minutes, 43 seconds. Even if you get the first down now and you score, you miss a two-point conversion, you're still down by two. If you take 3 points now, get the ball back, you're playing for the win when you get it. So I just think you should, right now, this situation, kick the field goal so that you get the ball back, you're winning the football game.
And speaking of field goals, I mean, Nick Carden, again, one of the better kickers in the SWAC, the left-footed kicker, strong leg. He is 4 for 4 between 30 and 39 yards coming in, 3 for 3 between 40 and 49 yards. So he has plenty of leg to make the field goal from these distances.
And there's one big thing that I haven't talked about. If you don't get it, you get nothing. So, I think you take the 3 points.
And this is not going to be easy against those big bodies of Alabama State that line up inside. On the reverse again. A lot of room, and he's got first down yardage and then more inside the 5 to the 2 yard line. Good call as Tevin McKenzie comes around and brings it out for 9 yards on the wide receiver reverse.
I told you that's why you go for it on fourth. Now, they must have seen something schematically that gave them the confidence that, no, we can get McKenzie, one of our best football players, on the edge and have him make a guy miss.
We have a player down for Alabama State. Deron Presley, the cornerback and their best cover guy, is down on the field.
This seems to be probably the third or fourth player we've seen go down with cramps.
And it is a warm day here in Birmingham. Got up close to 90. If it didn't reach 90 earlier today, now the sun pretty much set. Not much of a breeze down the field. Flags limp everywhere. And a lot of this crowd hanging around. Who will have the bragging rights after the 75th Magic City Classic? Alabama A&M marching, trying to take, or at least put themselves in position to tie this game if they go for a two-point conversion. I guess if you score a touchdown here, you almost have to.
Yeah, no question. No question. And a gutsy call. It lets you know what was at stake here. Coach Beatty in his mind, a electing to go for it, where I think most coaches would have taken the field goal opportunity on fourth and two. And he was rewarded with a big play, and they've got the ball on the 1 yard line. And see right there, one of the legendary faces you're going to see in all of HBCU football is in that picture right there. You know who it is? Gentleman right here wearing the hat. You know who that is?
No.
Young man with the best nickname in all of HBCU history, I believe. That, my friends, is Willie Satellite Totten.
Wow.
Right, you talk about somebody knowing a lot about the passing game. Willie Totten, legendary because he was Jerry Rice's quarterback in college at Mississippi Valley State. Now he's assistant coach over at Alabama A&M.
The gunslinger, Archie Cooley, the coach there.
I'm going to have to talk to Willie about D'Angelo Ballard's completion percentage. But this all-around great guy, always a pleasure to see. Satellite.
Yeah.
Is that a nickname for a quarterback?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, they had quite an offense back there in the late 70s, early 80s, with Willie Satellite Totten running the show, and Coach Cooley with his tight diamond formation with all five receivers in a diamond to one side or the other of the field, and they just lit up the scoreboard in Mississippi Valley State. And Totten, the quarterbacks and running backs coach, but you know, as you said, J.E. knows quite a bit about the passing game. This drive started at A&M's 35, 15 plays, 64 yards, 6.5 minutes right now, as they are knocking on the door at the one.
Back to the jet sweep.
The jet sweep with the wide receiver, and it's Tevin McKenzie who completes things and goes in for the touchdown. And this one will put the Bulldogs within two.
And obviously they're going to go for it down by two in this situation. I wonder how tempted they are to go back to the jet sweep. I mean, Alabama State is struggling stopping this jet sweep. They're trying to get it from inside out.
And that touchdown completed a 16-play mark, 65 yards, and here we go again. Jordan Bentley is the running back. And there it is in the pass. Oh, what an effort by the tight end, Kalias Robertson, who dragged the defender across the goal line into the end zone for the two. And we are tied in the Magic City Classic.
Uh-oh, Alabama State. You see, are you reading what I'm reading on the screen, Alabama State? Alabama A&M has won the last six Magic City Classics when the game's decided by 3 points or less. That means you better score some touchdowns.
That is some crack work by the statisticians around here to come up with something like that.
And what a great job by Kalias Robertson. Initially, you get the touchdown and on two-point conversion, we're tied up here in Birmingham.
Meet Riley. Nothing gets past her. Riley's asthma could slow her down, but it doesn't, because Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Alabama helps her manage it with free tools like MyRx Planner. She and her family get affordable coverage that includes routine annual checkups. Because we want our health coverage to work as hard as Riley plays. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Alabama, we cover what matters. Find out how we can find a family plan for you.
And we want to send a shout out and a thank you to the guys from Uncle Boo's Catfish Corner for feeding our ESPN crew today. They're down on the concourse serving up some of the best southern food for the soul. It looks good. Jay and I didn't get any, but you know, we got here a little bit late, I guess. So, you know, Uncle Boo, yeah, you can hook us up, but you know, I'm sure we'll get plenty of food after it's all said and done here. Alabama State starts fast again, 9-play, 86 yards and 4 drives, 14 points. Then next 5, they do very little. And then the last 3, 10 plays, 146 yards and 21 points. And they're going to be called on to see if they can continue some momentum that was wrested back by Alabama A&M, which went in for the tying 2-point conversion after the touchdown on a long march. And we are 35-35.
The kick continues. The ball will be spotted at the 35-yard line. First down.
Kickoff goes out of bounds. And it'll be placed at the 35, so decent field position for the Hornets. And Coach Brian Jenkins is they're going to try to pound this football and eat some clock and get the go-ahead score here. Quinteris Toppings back in there at quarterback. And the give goes off left guard, and number five, Alex Anderson, 6-footer, 200 pounds, out of Miami Gardens, Florida, who's come in and spelled Khalid Thomas, handled some of the power stuff inside. And that is Khalid Thomas, that time inside as well. And we talked about the power run game, two straight plays. They push the defensive line out of the way and pick up first down yardage on two straight runs.
Man, this is a different look. You see Thomas in the backfield along with Anderson, so they're going with a two-back set. Almost a pick your poison. You focus too much on Khalid Thomas, and Alex Anderson can hurt you.
And nice spin move that time, and boy, Anderson almost broke that one. He got into the secondary, but he still picked up good yardage on a couple of spin moves, 12 yards, and moved the sticks once again as Alabama State showing off that power run game inside.
Yeah, it's the two running backs that they have in there at the same time. Something they don't do much, so they start off in like an offset pistol, overload, then they go to a traditional split back formation.
Marquell Beckwith came on in the game, and now Beckwith takes it up the middle, bounces off a couple tackles, and gets it inside the 40. And so now we're inside of 7 minutes to go in this tie game. Avery Giles making the stop inside there after Beckwith picks up decent yardage on first down. It'll be second and six.
And what you're seeing right now is just 20 personnel. The two backs there, no tight end in the game. You're not seeing any substitutions by Alabama A&M, and they're having trouble stopping the run with the adjustments.
Going for it all, and he had a receiver who was breaking behind the defense, Willis White. One of the top targets for Alabama State at the wideout spot, but overshot him down the middle of the field. So it'll be third down and seven.
A little surprised they got away from running the football. On second down, you're running the ball 3 or 4 yards a clip. You want to eat a little clock as well as move the chains. And they got away from it, and now they're changing their personnel again, going with four wides.
Stoppage of play in the field. Didn't quite hear what the referee was saying there, but he did say first warning, so maybe it's against the band of Alabama A&M, not sure.
So this is all substitution. See, when you substitute, you have to give the defense 5 or 6 seconds to make an adjustment. Alabama State is running players out on the field late.
Toppings wide open over the middle and doesn't hold on to it. His intended receiver was Loia McCary. And McCary from Brooklyn, New York, the 6'2", 205-pound junior, could not hold it. So it appears that Alabama State might punt.
Look at the defender running to the official. Good job by McCary using the official there to give him a little screen. Defensive back didn't see him at all. Makes it even that more worse because there was nobody around him to catch him had he been able to hold on to the football.
Now they're over on the sideline talking it over, and the play clock's winding down here.
I mean, you see coaches on the field. This is not what, you know, they're going to punt the ball, but I saw water girls going out to the sideline. Alabama State's willing to take a delay of game penalty so they can punt the ball. They don't mind the 5 yards, give them more room in which to try and pin Alabama A&M back.
And that's exactly what's going to happen. And a walk off the 5-yard penalty for delay of game.
No, how come Alabama A&M does not have a return man back there? And they run him out on the field now.
Trevor Vincent back in deep punt formation. And back deep Again, more whistles. Now we have a timeout on the field. A&M is going to take a timeout and talk things over.
I don't like this timeout call. You know, there's some confusion. He's telling people get off, but you waste a timeout on a punt return in a game that's tied where the clock could become your enemy. You just double check that timeout with 6 minutes to go in this game. I believe timeouts are so much more valuable in the second half than they are in the first, particularly in close football games.
And Coach James Spady expending a lot of energy getting that timeout call. That time seems like he was trying to motion for a couple of guys to get off the field.
But all Alabama State was going to do was pooch punt. I mean, so impressive. I'm just curious about the use of those timeouts. You always want to have those at your disposal at the end of the game.
And the majority of the fans who started with us a few hours back as we kicked off the 75th Magic City Classic still here inside Legion Field in Birmingham. And, of course, many have migrated out with 100,000 or so more that are outside of the stadium in various tents and tailgate spots and barbecue grills. The smells, everything is just absolutely amazing.
And they'll probably come back in for the postgame.
Did we mention the Honeybees, their performance in halftime?
Great halftime, long halftime, and everybody, when the game's close, everybody stays around.
Rashad Anderson deep to receive this punt, which is going to be kicked to the far sideline, but it stayed in bounds somehow. And look at this. It rolls dead inside the 5-yard line. It'll be downed at the 4. And Alabama A&M has got 96 yards to go to try to make something happen to break this 35-35 tie.
The rugby-style kick takes a nice bounce. Good special teams play by the Hornets.
Finally on the third bounce, it lands out of bounds at the 4. Alabama A&M will take over.
The last drive we saw, Alabama A&M have some success running the football behind Brian Bauer and Tevin McKenzie with that jet sweep seemed to really give Alabama State trouble. I think you're going to see the jet sweep again, getting the ball in McKenzie's hand some point during this drive.
And we get a little movement inside early, and now they blow the whistle. And it's Roderick Henderson who's had a few of these instances where he's jumped the snap.
Offside, 94, defense with contact, 5-yard penalty, first down.
So Roderick Henderson, encroachment, gives him 5 yards, so it'll be first and 5, and gives Alabama A&M a lot more room to operate with now from their own 9-yard line. Another whistle and, of course, stoppage of play. And Coach Spady wondering, what now? No penalty. They stop the play to reset the football, I guess. So, first and 5. Bentley trying to come near side. Doesn't get much. No gain on the play.
Yeah, a little surprised they don't have Brower in the game. I thought Brower really did do a good job of spelling Bentley. A little bit more of the power running compared to the sideline and sideline running we've seen with Bentley with his great vision. But in this type of game, go with the hot hand.
Bentley going far side, gets the corner, and Bentley has enough for the first down as he'll be marked down at the 15-yard line. And he's taken down by Trayon Garnett after pickup of 7.
Good job by Alabama A&M capitalizing on the penalty from Alabama State. Able to pick up the first down with consecutive runs. Give himself a little breathing room.
Inside of 5.5 to go in regulation. We are tied at 35 in the 75th edition of the Magic City Classic here in Birmingham, Alabama. And that time, D'Angelo Ballard nowhere to go as he is sandwiched by a couple of tacklers, Andre Wilson, number 97, being one of them, and Darren Johnson, the other.
He's just not on the same page with his wide receiver. He wants to pull it up and throw hot right now. The receiver didn't make the hot adjustment from the linebacker blitzing on the outside, and Ballard had nothing else to do but just eat it.
Quick pass to the far side of the field and stopped immediately after the catch. On the far side is Ladarian Heath. And Heath will be brought down, setting up a third down situation. And a big one here for Alabama A&M. If they can't get a first down, you'd have to think, unless we get an unbelievable punt, a good roll, that Alabama State would have good field position if they force the opponents to punt.
Well, they should snap the ball. Yeah. Wow, we caught Alabama State with 12 men on the field. You had your quarterback behind your center. That's where you take a quick snap before they call timeout, pick up 5 extra yards.
And with 4:11 to go, Alabama State has to burn its second timeout. They have one remaining. It's all tied up at 35. We'll be back.
Line. 4 quarters, not enough.
If you haven't heard, Alcorn lost earlier today. And we get ready to set up the overtime rules for you.
That's Craig Bell. He used to play football down at Alabama A&M back in the day. Give him a quick shout out. Saw him randomly in the crowd.
Okay. You have that better than perfect vision. Overtime rules. And you get your coin toss. Each team will get one possession from the opponent's 25-yard line per overtime until the winner is decided. No game clock, of course. Play clock. Say that fast real time. A few times. Play clock only. Must go for a 2-point conversion when you begin the third overtime. I don't think anybody understood a word I said after all that stumbling. But
you know, normally you have one team going in with some momentum into overtime. In this case, I think it's a wash.
And it swung back and forth so many times.
You just have to question whether or not the kicking game for Alabama A&M might have lost a little confidence with that blocked field goal.
And of course, Big Roderick Henderson doesn't get off the ground too much. That one, not a lot of trajectory on it as he kicked it. He did have a lot of penetration, but that hit him more on the forearm than it even did on the hand. So not a lot of hype gotten on that one immediately by Nick Carden, the field goal kicker, who had been perfect from that distance coming in. So now they'll meet at midfield and have another coin toss, and we'll see who'll get the ball first in the overtime session.
The ex-pair rules are each team will get a series of downs. Each team will be given one timeout per series. After the third scoring attempt, the team must go for 2 in order to be given credit for points. Tossing the coin, whoever wins the coin toss will get to choose whether or not he wants to go on offense or defense, or choose the end of the field of which he wishes to play on. Your call. It's your call. Tails it is. Alabama A&M, you want to toss? You like to go on defense first. What end of the field would you like to play on? Play show back that way. Alabama State, we're going offense to start the extra period.
You know, it was interesting about that. Normally, if it's a home field game and it's overtime and you get to choose what side you want to defend. Mm. Well, if you're playing at home, you want to defend where your band is.
Right.
And you're on the road, you want to go away from the band or the student section. Well, here this is a neutral site game. Both bands are each positioned on the 20-yard line on one side. So there's really no benefit to playing on one end of the field because the bands are going to be part of it one way or the other if you play elect to play on one side of the field. So, see, this is the band right here, which is that's Alabama State's band, and then right over here you've got Alabama A&M's band, so they're going to elect to play on this side of the field away from all the band noise. That's what you see Courtney Berry's face, like, what side do you want to defend? He's like,
yeah, he's looking over. He's, down there. The south end, away from the VIP section.
Yeah, he didn't want to ruin the chandeliers.
That way. What a game we've had. 35 all as we are about to embark on overtime. The Hornets of Alabama State will get it first down and 10 on the 25-yard line of Alabama A&M.
I would pay attention to Willis White if I were Alabama A&M.
And on the fake to Khalid Thomas, who was popped at the line of scrimmage, Quinteris Toppings keeps it and picks up three. And I mean Khalid Thomas was popped. So second down, three receivers split to the near side right. Here's Khalid Thomas off the far side. Khalid Thomas breaking into the secondary and picks up first down yardage inside the 15 to the 14-yard line before Kenneth Davis brought him down.
And that was a statement run by Alabama State, where Alabama A&M was in a run-prevent defense, seven men around the line of scrimmage, and Thomas still able to find daylight and almost break it for the score. Look at all the red jerseys close to the line of scrimmage. That's run-prevent defense.
This is Mark Well. Beckwith. Beckwith into the end zone for the touchdown. And Alabama State strikes on its first possession of overtime.
But how does this happen? They have seven men close to the line of scrimmage to stop the run, but yet Beckwith was able to knife through. I mean, look how open that hole is. Poor gap control once again allows Beckwith easy access to get to the second level and to punch it in for the touchdown. They missed it.
Wow. The extra point attempt is no good. And David Albert, who again came into this game perfect on PATs, misses a big one. So if Alabama A&M scores and converts the extra point, this game is over.
They just pushed it to the right.
So Alabama State, not the best ending to their fifth rushing touchdown of the day, as David Albert pushes that extra point wide right. And so now Alabama A&M takes over at the 25. A touchdown and an extra point would win it for the Bulldogs. A little lateral on the far side of the field. That time it goes to Tevin McKenzie. And McKenzie is forced out of bounds after picking up only two. First time we've really seen that wrinkle in that play.
Yeah, a little trickeration. I thought they were setting them up to run the jet sweep, which I'm surprised we haven't seen again because that really gave Alabama State trouble having Tevin McKenzie get the ball on the edge. But if you get in a passing situation, look at the bottom of your screen, number six, LaDarian Heath.
And that pass to the far side is deflected. Coming over to knock that one away is Torrey Davis, number nine, backup linebacker. Got his hand on that one. Obviously two down territory here.
Yeah, this is a big third down. If you don't get the first down, you at least want to have it where it's fourth and less than two, where your playbook is open at your disposal.
The fake jet sweep this time, and Ballard keeps it and picks up six.
I'm not so sure that Ballard didn't call his own number. They set him up nicely for the jet sweep. Tevin McKenzie was coming across the formation, and I thought he might have scored a touchdown had they elected to give him the football.
Fourth down, they've been two for two on fourth down conversion so far in the game. They need a big one here on fourth and a long two. Ballard going in zone, wide open, touchdown! Jonathan Dorsey again.
Go for two. All they need is one right now. Dorsey, top of your screen, 87, gets a clean release. Who's responsible for him? That's a blown coverage.
Now Coach Spady is livid on the sideline. They're going to have to take a timeout to set up the extra point.
Right.
Take
a timeout, set up an extra point to win the Magic City Classic. That's not an issue. They're better safe than sorry.
Absolutely. And Coach Spady talked to us earlier this week, says, hey, I'm an in-your-face kind of coach. And he's getting into a few faces right now, but just complete an extra point. And you walk away with Magic City Classic.
Let's take a look and see how Jordan Dorsey gets so wide open. You have to think you've got to have a free safety that's covering. I'm assuming this is the person that's responsible for Dorsey in coverage. He's a tight end, gets a little too close to the line of scrimmage, and he's trying to get out there buzzing. I'm guessing it's Joshua Hill, freshman safety, playing in the key situation. Missed opportunity, missed coverage, and now Alabama A&M for the win.
He's missed three extra points in his career for the win.
College football.
How big is this game?
Huge game. James Spady heard all the critics out there, the naysayers, but winning the Classic, that normally gets them off your back for a little while, and it's a huge win for this program. Say what you want about James Spady, the overall record, but in the Magic City Classic, he's 2-1.
And their second victory in a row in conference. They get a big victory against Arkansas Pine Bluff last week, 40-7. Come back with 42 this week in an overtime thriller here in the Magic City Classic, which they won't let Alabama State fans forget for a whole year until we see the other one in 2017. 42-41 in overtime. They'll bring the Magic City Classic trophy out to the field, and that kind of night if you're a Hornet of Alabama State. Oh, so close. They miss an extra point here in overtime, and Alabama A&M hits their extra point with Nick Carden. And Alabama A&M's Bulldogs come away with a huge victory to move to 3-4 in the conference, while Alabama State falls to 2-5.
And we made this game even more important. Alcorn, the leading team in the SWAC Eastern Division, got their third loss today at the hands of Southern University. So a trip to Houston for the SWAC championship is still in play for Alabama A&M if they can run the table, and they're playing their best football at the right time of year.
Tip of the hat, a big hat, the Magic City Classic trophy Been brought out to the field to be presented to Alabama A&M. And Coach James Fady, 2-1 in this game in his third season at the helm of Alabama A&M. And, of course, Coach Brian Jenkins did not want to lose this contest on his watch, but this is a tough one to stomach after missing an easy extra point.
And look at the head coach, Fady. That water never felt so good.
You think they won a national championship the way they're celebrating down there. Really, they gave them the water shower, a couple guys doing backflips on the field. It's absolutely incredible. So there it is. The Magic City Classic Trophy going to be presented to Alabama A&M. It was a game that went back and forth and back and forth and back and forth again. Finally, the Bulldogs come away with a victory as they salute their fans. And now it's time to continue the party. There's over 100,000 people outside cooking everything else. We're cooked for this one. 42-41. A&M, a victory over Alabama State. For all of us here, victory over
Alabama State. For I can't.